Welcome back to the underground broadcast, motherfuckers. Happy Friday and cheers to y'all. Super Saiyan Joku's the first one here tonight. Let me hit it for this motherfucker. Cheers, Joku. Here we go.
I want to have the world.
The world's most comfortable pair of ultra soft.
I got a dumb son of a bitch trying to fucking text me right now. He knows who he is, so I'm just gonna fucking shut him the fuck up. I'm live on the broadcast, you idiot! I'm not gonna answer your phone right now, you dumbass! There. I put him in his place. That'll shut him the fuck up. Anyways, cheers, Joko! And cheers to that. This motherfucker, if he actually shows up or whatever... I just want to tell them, fuck you for fucking, you know I have a podcast at this exact fucking time. I don't know why the fuck you're trying to contact me right now, you dumb son of a bitch. I don't fucking shit all over you for fucking pulling that ass, dumbass. Anyways, cheers to Joku and cheers to the motherfuckers who are here. I don't know, there's only one motherfucker here and that's fine. That's all we like it. We only like a exclusive fucking, here he goes. Marcus Red, fuck you. Anyways, I'm putting my phone away. Fuck this guy. Trying to fucking, fuck up this channel live on a Friday night. Anyways, cheers to y'all. This motherfucker is a friend of mine. I haven't spoken to him in a while. I realized he called me last week during the podcast, I think. So I didn't answer. And then yesterday or the other day, I don't know when the fuck. Anyways, I called him. He didn't answer. That's the story. It's been 2 days in a row. I even texted him. I told him a bunch of profanities on a text message. He probably saw it at work and he's mad. But yeah, now he's trying to talk to me. When he knows, goddammit, I start the show at exactly 7:30. Fuck you. All right, anyways. Cheers, Joku. Happy Friday. It's been a fucking shitty week. But we always persevere and we keep going forward because in life, nothing matters. At the end of the day, we all end up in the same goddamn place. And we find out. You were us all along. Anyways, this is going to be a good show, I hope. Let me show you what's going down tonight. We're going to have our first look at The Crow. We got new images and shit, everyone's talking about it. Miles Morales is supposedly finally coming to MCU. We got episode 5 of Shitty Halo coming for you, as well as the entire Last Airbender review for the whole series. And we can't finish this show without talking about the celebrity ass for the week. So you know that's coming up. Cheers to y'all, but as always, we gotta start with the motherfucking comments, so let's get to that. My social media is at sunofman 665 for Twitter, at the underground broadcast for the other two, TikTok and Instagram. I don't know, as long as you subscribe to one of them, you're gonna see, because it's the same shit, you know. We don't take time to do anything different for all of them. Here we go. Joku, before I read the comments, if you send me anything to those social medias, I will post it here. So here we go. Super Saiyan Joku who sent me these. He's got some drinks there. We'll go over them in a little bit. But he sent me this on IG. And it says, I'm starting late, but I'm going to stay awake and bake at the underground broadcast to get this ad. All this ass. Son of man, leave me some of the...
Live.
Oh, yeah. Cheers, mother flowers. Hashtag THC, hashtag drinks, hashtag Mary Jane, hashtag marijuana, and hashtag smoke weed every day. Oh yeah, look at these drinks, this son of a bitch. He lives in a good state where all this shit is legal. Sweet heal, that one heals the soul, they say. Yutz, maple cream soda, it's got 5 milligrams of THC, knock you on your ass. And kind of refresher infused with cannabis, that's a seltzer, motherfucker. Holy shit, that feels like cum going down your throat. I've heard. I don't know. I don't drink those seltzers. I'm just saying. Yeah, here he is, Alejandro Tumble. Son of a bitch. Echale. Hey, pásalo. Cheers, you dumb son of a bitch. Yeah, Joku, are you at a bar? What bar are you at? Or is that at work? You better not be at work drinking this, taking those shots and shit. You look like a friend of mine I used to have, Joku, some motherfucker. You look just like him. Yes, not the cum part. Cheers, motherfuckers. All right, let's get away to comments. Oh, on the Kanye exposes his wife. This is like the 60th video we've done with the same title. It says Bianca chooses to dress like this. Yeah, I mean, she chose to marry the guy. It's their lifestyle. Obviously, Kanye wanted Kim to do this, but Kim is not all the way whore. She's just a whore. And she tries to keep it on the down low, but I mean, because she's famous, they still capture it on film and on cameras. This chick is a whore right up front, and Kanye likes that. There's nothing wrong with that, all right? If some people are into that. She's into that, and they found each other, and they're happy, motherfuckers. I don't know why people are giving them shit, because these motherfuckers are happy, and they're doing what they like. All right, she dresses like that. Yes, he tells her, this will look fine on your fucking ass. And yeah, she probably agrees and says, yeah, I would. Fuck yeah, we're gonna get tons of clicks. We're gonna be all over the news and shit. And she puts it on. She's happy with it. So is he. So yeah, I'm with you, Hexy West Live. Cheers! She does. You know, there's nothing wrong with it. There's nothing wrong with it. Yeah. I was drinking at work at the bar, to the bar. Oh, the cunt is here! Let me hit it for this asshole!
You can feel it while smoking. You can feel it while drinking. You can feel it getting woke as fuck. So get your slob ready, cause the cunt is here.
Oh, Colin Larson says konnichiwa, bitches! Cheers, Colin! Alejandro Trumblay, I know our other friend said he was going to make a comment, an intro for you one day, and he never did. Son of a bitch. If you show up two more times to our live, you asshole, I will make you a fucking an intro just because I know you. Son of a bitch. I need to talk to you, so you better fucking represent and call me tomorrow, you dick. Anyways, here we go. Smoke weed, watch WNBA. Oh shit, that is actually something I've never done, and something tells me that smoking weed and then watching a WNBA game would be awesome, bro. When my friends used to come over every New Year's, I used to get everyone drunk and fucking high, and then I would put on The Room, and they all hated it, but fucking after a while they would get into it and they'd fucking start laughing and shit, you know what I'm saying? I love the room. I love fucking Tommy Wiseau. He's a shit. I'll just say it like that. I fucking wish I could meet that guy. I would try to bring him on this podcast. I don't know if he would, you know what the fuck was going on, but I would. Cheers, y'all. Sacalo. It's right here, motherfucker. It's a sacalo loco, which means take it out, motherfucker. It's a good shit, so I gotta use the one-hitter for the good shit. Besides, y'all don't want me too fucked up, because then I'm gonna be able to do the show and shit. Just saying. Let's keep reading the fucking comments. Oh, Anthony Windham 9665. I think this guy's commented before, because that name sounds really, really familiar. But he says, it would be nice to get a God of War movie instead of shitty Spider-Man spin-offs. Do you know what? They're making a God of War series, and they're making a Ghost of Tsushima movie. This is Sony. Sony's doing this. The God of War series, unfortunately, is not going to be Kratos. It's going to be basically the new games with the little boy, because they got to be woke. As long as it's... I don't know, man. It would be cool, man. But they gotta pick the right motherfucker for Kratos, man. Because if they pick a black guy, I'm gonna get pissed. He's gotta be a Greek motherfucker. He gotta look like Randy Orton and shit. Randy Orton would have been the perfect... Actually, nowadays, because he's a lot older, he would still be the perfect Kratos. Fucking spray paint that motherfucker pale white. Ghost White, you know, fucking Randy Orton is perfect Kratos. I'm just saying, get him, make him have a beard, because now he's gonna be old and shit. I don't know, for the little boy, they can get Tom Holland. Tom Holland could be the little boy. I forget what his name was. He would just say, "Boy, read this, boy." I love that game. The first, I didn't play the second one because I didn't buy a PS5. Fuck you, Sony. But yeah, that's fucking badass. God of War movie would have been cool. I would have loved to see Kratos story brought to life. No, we're getting the new one with him and his son, and it's going to be a series. I don't know where it's going to be. I don't know where Sony's going to shop it to or sell it to, but it is going to be a series. And the Ghost of Tsushima, which is a game I fucking love on the PS4. Ghost of Tsushima is badass, motherfuckers. That one is, it's basically Assassin's Creed in Japan, but it's perfect. That game is fucking perfect. That one's going to be a fucking movie that Sony's working on. Yeah. Ragnarok on PS4. Is it on PS4? Shit, I don't know. You know what happened is that I didn't buy it, and I sat down and I watched a video of somebody do the whole playthrough. So I know what the movie is. Yeah. I don't know. We'll see what they do, man, because nowadays everything's a flip of a coin, man. They either do it justice or they fuck it up. You all have seen the monstrosities they've been giving us in the past. You know, some things are passable, and we'll talk about some of the stuff I'm going to review tonight. But other stuff is just ass. Whatever. Let's see. Anthony Wyndham, he did comment again, and he said, "I just joined the channel, and you keep it real, my dude. I just give you my opinions, straight up. You know, son of man, and the way he thinks, might be a little unorthodox, might be a little unconventional, it might be a little too woke, even for the woke people. But God damn it, I will always spit the truth." Well, why? I'll tell you why. Because my mama told me you should always be an honest man. And I try to do the best I can. That's why they call me the son of man. Cheers. And by the way, thank you for joining. This channel got a bunch of subscribers this week. I was not expecting it. Thanks, y'all. I hope you don't unsubscribe. I'll do my best. Let's see who else is here. Oh, again? Anthony Wyndham said, "Keep doing what you like." Yeah. I'll keep doing me all day, every day. I'll give a fuck. That's how we do in this channel. We just give you our opinions. You can give your opinions as long as you're not flooding the freaking chat and you're not being a really, really dick. No, these guys are not going to block you. You wonder why these guys have wrenches is because these are some of the motherfuckers that showed up from the beginning. This channel's been running for 3 years, unfortunately, on year number 4. It's changed completely. Not by my choice. But anyways, yeah. So this is technically year number 1 for the Underground Broadcast. We're not a podcast anymore. This channel is now a broadcast. So cheers. We'll do my best. And we'll keep this channel alive. As long as people come in here and they drink and they smoke on a Friday night, so will I. And besides, I need this, right? I'm sober all fucking week now. And, you know, God damn it. You got to work and be a fucking drone on ant for a paycheck to survive. And the people at work are fucking assholes. I don't know why. They're mad because they got to pay child support to a fucking bitch. They fucking got pregnant. They're all mad. Motherfucker, you should have pulled out and came on their face. It's not my fault. You got to come in here and bring your bad attitude and fuck someone else's day up. Fuck you. Anyways, enough of that. We're moving on. We're doing our own thing like we always do. And we persevere because that's all it is. You just got to keep going, moving forward. Good advice, Disney. Keep moving forward. Meet the Robinsons. It's a good movie. All right, let's keep going. Oh, my God. It's our resident fucking Asian, Robo Iger. Let me hit it for this asshole. And this motherfucker says, "What up, my brown skin friend?" Oh, that's badass. I like that. You could say tan also, or burnt. I like burnt, you know, crispy, not too crispy. "I finally have a day off and I'm home alone, watches this." Is that a, what is that? I hate these emojis because I don't know what they are. It looks like a shit, but it's gray. Oh, it's a rock. I get it. He's home alone and he's watching this stoned as fuck. Ah. These emojis need to get better. It's 2024. They need to make better pictures for these assholes. I don't know. I don't know what that was. It looked like clay. But I get it. Don't worry, Robo. I got it. Cheers to the woke pack. Oh, yeah. Hey, my son. Let's see what this says. Sorry. Every time I open it, look at this. Look at this ass. Every time I open it, it fucks up. Here, read more. There we go. Hey, my son plays Borderlands. I get what you mean when you say it hurts your eyes. It bothers mine too. Cheers, son. Keep up the good work. And hashtag... live. Yeah, I mean... I think I had a roommate at one point who fucking, he played Borderlands. And, I couldn't get into it because, like I said, it fucking hurt my eyes and shit. So, I mean, it's just not to my liking. So, I don't know. The cunt was shitting all over the fucking, fucking trailer and shit. I don't know nothing about Borderlands. I never played the game. I don't like how the game looks. I'll watch the movie. I don't know if it's going to be any good, but I'll watch it. I'm not going to pay for it. Of course not. Yeah. The cunt says something like, he who should not be named, racist remarks really was holding you back. He did get, man, sometimes, I mean, after the show, I would be like, dude, you came off pretty there. Like, you're like, easy on the gay bashing, bro. I'm supposed to be the bad one. You're coming off as a fucking dickhead. Yeah. Nah, just like, we're different cultures, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, he's from... Well, we've talked about this. I don't get too much into it, talk too much about him. But, you know, he's still raised even more differently than me. I can tell you, our parents are really racist. If y'all consider what you guys consider racist, our parents, his and mine's are really fucking racist just because of where the country they come from and shit. But, you know, it's all funny. I mean, to me, I don't fucking, you know, I can say these things, you know, like I would be at work and be saying, like, you know, like, because, you know, I'd be the only one who speaks Spanish and they come up to me and they'd be like, hey, there's a Mexican up front. Can you come talk to him? And be like, God damn it. Why didn't we finish building that wall? And then everybody be like, but then a few of them would giggle. And I'm like, yes, that's what I like. A brown person said it. You can laugh, motherfuckers. And then they started laughing and shit. And I'm like, yeah. Calm down. I think the same thing you think sometimes. All right. There's nothing wrong. It's fucking normal. I don't hate anybody. I dislike people. Mostly motherfuckers with bad attitudes and fucking think they're better than everybody. Motherfucker, you're not better than anyone in the world. Alright? At any given fucking Sunday, somebody will show you up, plain and simple. And it could be a fucking old man who shows you the fuck up. That's all I'm saying. Don't ever think you're better than somebody, no matter how much money or how much fucking fame or fortune or skills and qualities you have and degrees. Fuck you. At any given Sunday, a homeless person can show you the fuck up, motherfucker, and shut you the fuck up. I'll just put it like that. But yeah. Cheers to Robo. I like Robo a lot. He's one of our Asian friends. My only Asian friend. Basically, I come from a town that ain't no Asians. What are you going to do? And actually, you know what? The only little Asian girl that there, I dated. I'll just put it you like that. Cheers! All right, let's see who's next. Oh, the cunt. Hey, cheers, the cunt. About to read his thing on the Daredevil board again. Punisher leaks. He says, Frank Castle is back, and the only thing he will be punishing is Kevin Feige's booty cheeks. LOL. Yeah. I'm excited about Daredevil. I really am. I'm trying not to fucking shit on it too much. I don't like, because, you know, the stuff I'm showing you guys, I'm going to show you some new stuff tonight, or talk about some new stuff tonight. But the stuff I show you guys is basically pre-production or post or whatever. It's before they add special effects, before they fix it, the lighting and everything in the fucking programs. I know that stuff because I fucking do it sometimes. Not on this, but I do it on some of the other stuff I used to do and whatnot. So I know what it takes to make it look different. So I try not to shit on it too much, and I am excited about it, but at the same time, Kevin Feige's track record the last couple of years has really fucking gone down the shithole. That's all I'm gonna say. All right, so sometimes you just gotta base it on what you've been feeding me. If you've been making nothing but ass, and I've been eating it and being like, this is ass. What?
Oh, this one's gonna be better.
I don't know, man. You've been giving me nothing but ass. So I don't know what to think. You know, that's all I'm saying. You know. The MCU is dead. Now, well, you know what? Nothing ever truly dies because these franchises will live forever. But as far as the MCU, as it is at a point in time where they're not making billion-dollar franchises, yes. It is in that point in time where they're not making billions of dollars. And that's Marvel and Disney's own fault. Right? It is. Their agendas are fucking stupid. Like, there's ways to put gays and lesbians in movie without doing it the way you're doing it, you idiots. That's all I'm saying. There are ways. There are ways. Just saying. Other movies have done it successfully. I don't know why these assholes have to be like, oh, here you go. He's a lesbian. Why? I just, you know, let me get into it. We go over in this channel. All right, don't worry about it. Cheers to the cunt. Thank you for coming. Oh, my God. This fucking racist, misogynist son of a bitch. None other than No Ma'am commented. Let me fucking hit it for this guy.
No Ma'am. National Organization of Men Against Amazonian Masterhood.
All right, cheers, No Ma'am. Let me drink for you, you fucking racist. This doesn't surprise me. On the Spider-Man 4 is in trouble already. At this point, these studios have to just take a break. A literal 5-year break, and then reboot everything from the start with new actors. It has gone sour. Deadpool and Wolverine will get people back into theaters, but it won't be able to recreate that with any other of their own failed IPs. Cheers, son. Hashtag. Live. I totally agree. The cunt just said, mate, Deadpool is gonna save it. Deadpool and Wolverine is the only movie, Marvel, Disney movie, because Sony's releasing a lot of ass. They already released Madam Web. They're going to release a lot more ass. I think Venom and Kraven the Hunter are going to release. That's going to fail too. Both of those. But the only movie Marvel Disney will release this year is Deadpool and Wolverine. That's it. And yes, it will make them $1 billion again. But all the movies they're filming right now, they're going to lose money again. It's the same shit show over and over and over again. They literally need what this guy said, a reboot. The same thing they just did to fucking DC, where James Gunn says, that's it, everything's gonna end, and I'm starting from brand scratch new next year. That's exactly what Marvel needs. But they actually need, I would say it as far as what this guy says, they need a 5-year break. I think Star Wars would have worked out if they actually would have taken a break after the last fucking shitty movie with the Return of Skywalker or whatever the fuck it's called. That movie was ass. After that, they should have taken a 5-year break. And then after the 5-year break, then do The Mandalorian and all the other stuff. Maybe it would have been more palatable because it's been a while. But you kept on doing it right afterwards. Shows and shit. And people are just like, if you're not going to give you quality, then you're going to get tired of it. You get exhausted of ass. You get tired of ass. I do, sometimes. You know, if you get too much ass, you get tired of it. All right? You need to get something else sometimes. You know what I'm saying? But anyways, yeah, it happens. I'm with you, No Ma'am. They really do need to take a break or a reboot. Just restart new actors. Every new actor. I'm tired of Brie Larson and Mark Ruffalo running their fucking mouths in every interview. Like, God damn it. Like, I don't give a shit what you believe in. Shut the fuck up and just play the character, you idiots. You're making it bad for everyone. That's all I'm saying. Anyways, cheers, No Ma'am. Let's see who's next. Oh, some guy named Racer C45 on the Spider-Man 4 is in trouble. Is this supposed to be a joke video? No, it's supposed to be about talking about the Spider-Man 4 movie is in trouble already. You not read the title? I don't know if you saw the video. I don't know if there was any jokes in there. I mean, all I said was the facts that's happening. This is a channel where we talk about celebrities and comic book nerd shit. And I read your comments during the week. That's it. Oh, and we drink and get high. And sometimes I'm drunk and I don't know. Also, I have a different point of view and I'm a little unconventional. I might say something you not agree with or something you might think is funny. That's fine too. Everybody's taste is different. Thank you for commenting, Racer C45. Cheers. I'm a loading new fucking one hitter for you. All right, let's see who's next here. Oh, okay. This was a thread that happened. But on the Godzilla vs. Kong Mothra leaks, Zach Brock. Oh, that's a badass name. I'm not going to lie. And he looks tough. Look at him. He's got a mean mug and he's fucking got a beard. That's badass. He says, I'm pretty sure it was showing that Mothra laid eggs before she died. Maybe this is just her evolving, hatching. Interesting theory. But I gotta be a fucking nerd and a dick and say, if she was laying eggs as she was dying, which, if I remember correctly, she fucking died on top of Godzilla. Then where did the eggs go? Godzilla carried them around and go and put them back in the Hollow Earth? Because I think that's where this new Mothra is going to be born, is in the Hollow Earth, from what I can tell in the trailers. It's an interesting theory, but I just think this is going to be a brand new Mothra. It's just another cocoon was just literally somewhere else. You know, yeah. Or maybe this guy means that The first Mothra laid eggs around the world or the Hollow Earth, and you know, I just think it's going to be a different one. It's still, they're going to call it Mothra, but I just think it's not the same one, obviously, because it died. It's not the same one from the last movie. So yeah, we did have another dude comment on his, and his name was Christopher Dornenberg. Is that German? I don't know. Shit. It's definitely not American. But anyways, this guy says, most likely she looks different because it's going to be a Mothra reborn. Just like in the Toho films, she will evolve from hatching. Yeah, it is. I don't think it's her reborn. It's just another moth, another cocoon and shit. And they just call it Mothra because whatever. They just call it Mothra. Because what else are you going to call it? It's a moth and it's a god to them. Mothra. God. That's what he's called, Mothra. I like when you motherfuckers comment on your comments. We don't get that a lot. But I like that, Christopher Dornenberg. And Mr. Zach Brock. Cheers to you motherfuckers. And thank you for fucking commenting on this channel. Cheers. You're giving us a view, for fuck's sakes. All right, let's see. Oh yeah, Super Saiyan Joku. He says, don't hate on the haters, target Miss Westie. It's your bestie. Don't try to test me. It's gonna get messy. So just bless me. So just bless me. You don't want no problems. Oh yeah. Anyways, she says, don't hate. It's not like she's spitting bars. She's spitting what, like, 10-year-old would sound like. And represent her dad to the fullest. I love it. And for yay, gorgeous wife, she makes me pee-pee sneeze. Cheers, mother flowers. Hashtag. Live. Ah, fucking Joku. Yeah, I mean, everybody's talking shit about this little girl saying that Kanye's corrupt. This little girl is literally looks up to her father and thinks her father's badass. There is absolutely nothing wrong with that. Fuck you. It would be shitty if she thought her dad was a horrible person and shit. But she doesn't. She obviously thinks her dad's some kind of hero and she likes it. You know, and she likes that he does music and she wants to do it too. So it's like, dude, like, you could say whatever you want about Kanye. He may be a little unorthodox. He may be a little crazy. He may be fucking really fucking rich. Richer than any of us will ever be. But I will tell you one thing. He's a good father. You know, he is in his children's lives. He goes to their goddamn basketball games. Yeah, he shows up in a fucking Escalade with the license plate 666. But he still goes to their goddamn fucking basketball games and shit. How many motherfuckers out there who are have children all over town, fathered everywhere, don't even fucking know their names and shit. Fuck you, Kanye's a good motherfucker for at least fucking being a dad to his kids and being such a good dad that his kids look up to him. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of people that grew up and they didn't look up to their parents. They'd be like, fuck this, the motherfucker, I'm gonna try to be better than this asshole. And I'm just saying, don't fucking be judging the Yeezy just because he's different than you. That's all I'm saying. All right, cheers, Joku. Joku also on the Machine Gun Kelly gets a new tattoo and shit. It says, Machine Gun Kelly is a clown. If it's permanent and he's still a clown. If it's just paint, hey, Machine Gun, give me Megan so I can make her the whore she truly can be. She needs to dump the loser. Cheers, mother flowers. I will tell you one thing about Megan Fox. She doesn't need this guy to be a whore. She's done it by herself. And God bless her, because you know what? Her face is amazing. Because everything else is fake. I mean, her boobs are fake, for sure. She not got much of an ass, you know. But, you know, you bend them over, they all have an ass. Cheers! An ass is an ass, fellas. Aw, yeah! Alright. It's gonna get too crazy here. Joku also says on the disrespect of Scottie Pippen. Pippin be pimping. Marcus, keep her face moisturized with that man lotion. Cheers. Oh, yeah. Oh, man, I don't know. It's just fucked up, bros. The whole situation's fucked up. All I'm saying is that if you have kids and your son wants to date your friend's ex-wife, I hope you fucking slap the shit out of him and tell him no. That's all I'm saying. But cheers to you, Super Saiyan Joku, for commenting on debaucheries. Because that's basically what this whole channel is. It's a fucking walking debauchery. Alright. We have a new one! On the Godzilla Kong Mothra leaks. It's this, you know what? The avatar got me curious enough that I went and clicked on his shit and I wanted to see who this guy was. Not because of his comment, but because of his avatar. It's like a balloon or something with a face, and then it's like a little drawing of a kid with some red hair or something. I went to his channel. This guy's a kid. And he has tons of videos. And he's a big Godzilla nerd. He has tons of videos. And for a kid, I gotta tell you, some of these videos are pretty damn good. I'm like, at the very least, this kid's really good at editing, chopping shit up, making videos. And he's a big Godzilla nerd. He's a big fan. He loves Godzilla. Because that's all the videos he makes. I saw a lot of... I got lost. I was super high and I was like, this is a fucking kid. I kept watching shit. Mace DeMarco. Fuck it. I'm gonna do this live. I wanted to do this live on the fucking show here. But I'm gonna fucking subscribe to your channel, dude. Subscribe right there. Underground Broadcast, just subscribe to you, motherfucker. Bendy and Mace DeMarco. And the drawing, I'm not gonna show it because he's a kid. I'm not gonna scroll up and show you guys. But it's his cat. He's got a cat and he's there. And this fucking kid's this kid's badass. I'd be proud to have this kid as my son. I'll just tell you like that. Thank God I don't have any kids. All right, I can barely afford to feed my dog. I don't need another little human fucking baby asking me for food every day and night. Fuck that. Anyways, let me read this guy's comment. Yeah, cheers, Mace DeMarco. Bendy and Mace DeMarco. I think Bendy is his fucking cat's name. That's fucking badass. But anyways, let me see what he put here. He put up, why did you put spoilers in the title and the thumbnail? So because on the Godzilla Mothra leaked video, on the edge, I put spoiler alert. But then on the actual title of the video, at the end, I put open quotations and it says spoilers, duh. You need asking why I did that. Because there are actual idiots out there that will watch the video and then they didn't do it this time, but they've done it in the past. Where they'll complain and say, why the fuck are you spoiling the movie? Some of us want to watch it without it. It's in the title. All right, well, let me put it on the picture. Because obviously you're too fucking dumb. I mean, it even says leaked. I'm just saying, I've had incidents like that where I'm just like, the fucking idiots, you know? There's dumb people out there. So, because of those dumb people, I have to do this. I have to put on the title of the actual thumbnail that says, Mothra, it leaked. And then I put a Thunder thumbnail that says, spoiler alert. And then I have to write it in capital letters. Spoilers, duh. You idiots. Because just people are dumb. Mace, DeMarco, you're going to meet a lot of dumb people as you grow up. That's life. But you're also going to meet a lot of people that are smarter than you. That's life. Cheers. And thank you for watching. I subscribe to you. I don't know if you're a subscriber. You're probably not. You don't give a fuck about this channel. And honestly, you're too young to be watching us. But cheers, motherfucker. Oh my god, let me make sure this is the last comment. It is, but it's none other than Houston, Texas only, Jose Trevino! Let me hit it for this asshole.
Repites tu nombre, por favor.
Houston, Texas. Soy americano mexicano, señor. Para que usted se cuadre, ¿ok?
Cheers, Jose Trevino, you fucking loco motherfucker. I just finished a beer for you, motherfucker. He says, on the Spider-Man is Ruined video, excuse me for that, Sony at it again, not knowing how to read the room and being dumb. Yeah. It's not just Sony. At this point, it's Marvel. Like, Marvel was at the point they were sucking us so much that they agreed to make a partnership and share Spider-Man. And that's been the only good thing that two shitty studios have been able to produce something good, because by themselves, they have not been able to feed us anything good. They have to work together to make one good franchise, and that's Spider-Man. And right now, it's in peril because these two idiots can agree what the next movie's gonna be. To me already, this sounds like this could be the end of it. And I hope Tom Holland realizes that this is a shit show and maybe he should jump shit. And maybe he is. We're going to talk about that tonight for later for the spoilers. Of course, you know, that's going to come after the weekly celebrity breakdown that we're going to have in just a few minutes. It's shit. But we are done with the comments. I want to thank each and every one of you who watched one of these videos and who commented. You're very much appreciated. And like I said, we read every motherfucking comment on this channel. It doesn't matter what you say. If you want to make fun of how I look and how I live, go right ahead. You ain't going to hurt my fucking feelings. All right. There's worse shit happening in my life right now that this ain't nothing. All right. Internet bullshit comments. And it ain't nothing. So go ahead and put it, I'll read your comments, and I'll give you the DJ horn. Yeah. If you send me anything to the social medias, I'll show it here too. It doesn't have to be fucking paraphernalia, like the way Super Saiyan Joku showing off that his state is better than everyone else's, because everything that's illegal is legal in his state. Fuck you. But yes, it doesn't have to be paraphernalia. You see a horse, you take a picture, I'll put it on here. Whatever the fuck you send me, I'll put it on here. I don't give a fuck. That's how shitty our channel is. But anyways, I thank each and every one of you for watching, and we're done with the comments. I'll take one last hit for you. All right, I'm gonna grab another beer right here. We can get going, my friends, and we're gonna start with the weekly pop culture breakdown. All right, we got to start with the bad news, unfortunately. We're back at it again. Downer news. This week, we lost comedian Richard Lewis at 76 years old from a fucking heart attack. I'm going to be honest, he didn't look in good shape at all. This motherfucker looked like he was 80. I don't know if he looked 76. I remember him from TV and shit. I think he did stand-up. I think he was on Curb Your Enthusiasm. And I remember him from Robin Hood, Men in Tights. I don't know if y'all remember that. It was like a parody of Robin Hood and shit. That's where I remember him from. Yeah. He passed away and shit. 76. It's just weird when you see people that you remember seeing when you were young dying. It's a weird thing, you know? I'll just say it like that. Cheers to Richard Lewis. You'll be remembered for a little bit, and then people will forget. Unless you're Elvis or something of that caliber, you're not going to be remembered for that long. But cheers to you, because you left some kind of mark in life. Cheers. Unfortunately, we're not done with the downer news, because in the wrestling world, we did lose Ole Anderson, one of the original founding members and cousin of Arn Anderson, one of the original founding members of the Four Horsemen, passed away, my friends, at the age of 81 years old. I don't know what. I mean, 81's really old. I wouldn't be surprised if it was natural causes of death. But let's be honest, this motherfucker never really, I mean, none of them ever lived a healthy lifestyle. I'm surprised Ric Flair's still fucking alive. Yeah. Arn Anderson, too. So, I don't know. It could have been Hart Fairler. Could have just been regular shit. I don't know. Could have been other shit. I don't know. The man died. And for wrestling fans everywhere, he is going to be missed. I'll just put it like that. Mr. Anderson, cheers to you. I'm going to miss you. You know, I'm the Four Horsemen. Come on, man. That's where this comes from at all. All right. Straight up. They're the first gang and shit, I think. The first little group, little clique. Shit. Cheers to old Ole Anderson. But we're not done, unfortunately, with the bad news and with the wrestling news. Because none other than Michael Virgil Jones passed away as well at the age of 61. And this guy was in phenomenal shape. But he had a few strokes. He had colon cancer. They didn't say exactly what he passed away, but once you get colon cancer, I mean, it's cancer. 61. This guy was really underrated. And, you know, for a guy back in the day, because I'm going to be honest with you, you know, brown people were not showcased in wrestling a lot back in the fucking, in the 80s or even in the 90s and shit. You know what I'm saying? The only reason people know The Rock's dad is because he's The Rock's dad. All right? It's not like he was fucking center spotlight like Hulk Hogan. He wasn't. That's the way it was back then. This guy was a lackey to fucking the Million Dollar Man and shit. And they tried to fucking break them up like this. Thought he was going to become big, but it just wasn't a thing. Because it just wasn't, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't the fucking image back then. But he's highly underrated. But even though, you know, they still used him a lot, I'll put it that. And, you know, even in the NWO, when they put him in, there are a lot of people that make fucking asshole jokes saying, you know, the NWO, when it got bad, when you knew it was like, all right, that's it, this is too much, is when they let Virgil in. And I was like, nah, fuck you, man. That's some shitty shit to say. You know, the NWO got shitty when there was like 27 members in it. All right, that's when it got shitty. It had nothing to do with Virgil. Like, yeah, oh, another guy's joining? Yes, yes, I get it, you know, but it doesn't matter. Like, this guy was good. This guy was cool, man. And I don't think he was given the right, I don't know. I think he would have thrived better in the landscape nowadays. I'll just put it like that. But it sucks that we lost this man at 61 years of age, man. I'll just put it like that. Especially somebody who's an athlete and in good shape. And to see him get beaten by cancer, it just pisses me off. Because we're in the year 2024. All right. There's a pill you can take that will fucking pretty much cure you of AIDS. Cancer. One of the oldest known diseases. It's been around forever. It still doesn't have a cure, but there's plenty of treatments. There's plenty of options and treatments you can try. It costs you money. There ain't no cure. Fuck you. Yeah. Go ahead and be debaucherous and get AIDS. You get a pill you take every day, you'll live a normal life, and you won't even spread it. Fuck you. We still have to live with cancer. Everything you feed us, the food, and all this fucking dicks. Everything gives us cancer. The goddamn air you breathe. Because you wake up in the air, you see them put in the chemtrails and shit. I see them every morning. You're poisoning us, you idiots. I go and buy toothpaste and I make sure it doesn't have fluoride in it. No fluoride in my toothpaste. Fuck you, there's already fluoride in the water. It's getting out of control, y'all. Anyways, I'm sorry, I went off topic here. Cheers to Virgil. Michael Jones, we'll miss you, my friend. Cheers. But let's get into it. What everybody on the internet has been talking about. Talk of the town. P. Diddy. Because on top of the numerous accusations from all these females, apparently now there is an ex-producer that worked for Bad Boy Records. His name is Rodney Jones. And he is now suing, along with these women, P. Diddy. For sexual abuse and molestations and a bunch of other ass. I'll get into the details in just a little bit. But in case you all didn't know what the fuck's been going on with Puff Daddy, I don't know why you wouldn't know. We'll go ahead and recap some of this ass for some of you. First, Cassie came out. This is his ex. Shit. One of his exes. And she came out and she said, you know, like, this guy, he would rape me. Shit. He would drug me, and then, like, when I was on drugs or on ecstasy, he would, like, you know, fucking give me to his friends, and I'm pretty sure they paid him money, and they would fuck me and shit. Yeah. That's what she claims. We have another chick named Joy Dickerson / Neil or whatever. She uses two names, just like in Mexico. She says that he drugged and raped her in New York City in 1991, and she was just a college student. Of age, college student. I think we went over this before, but I think they invited her to come watch them record a song and shit. And she's like, yeah, I want to see how you make hits. And so she went along. They drugged her. And then him and the friend that Puff Daddy had, they fucked her and they filmed each other with it. And then they all drugged and all dazed and confused. They put her in a limo and sent her ass home. That's what this chick is claiming. There's only two women that apparently were underage at the time of their incidents. So they cannot legally say their names, even though they are of age right now. They can't say their fucking names right now. Because at the time, the crime was supposedly done. They were underage. So we don't know their names. Jane Doe, number one, says that Puffy and this other guy who writes songs, Aaron Hall, they took turns raping her. After she was drugged in her apartment. And then this other girl is saying that Puff Daddy and three other guys, they gang raped her in 2003. And she was only 17. They gave her a bunch of drugs. Well, people are saying, well, how are they getting all these drugs and shit? Well, this guy, Little Rod Jones, he's coming out and he's saying he's got harassment assaults. And that Puff Daddy was trying to groom him and shit. to pimp him out. And he gives details, and you kind of get a picture of what exactly was going on with these little girls. But according to this motherfucker, Puff Daddy did the kind of environment he was in. He says, he would call me for a meeting at his house, and I would go, and his assistant would lead me into his bedroom to the shower. And he has, fucking window showers, so everything's clear. And he's there naked, fucking showering and fucking jerking off or whatever. And that's where he wants to have the meeting like that. And I was like, you want to have the meeting later? And Puff Daddy's like, no, they're wasting time. They were having the meeting. I'm washing my dick and my ass and fingering my asshole. You're watching, tell me what kind of songs we're doing and shit. He's like, it's fucking weird. And then, not only that, but he says, Puff Daddy would bring all these, hookers, and a lot of them were underage. They were not even of age. And he goes, they look like little girls, and he would bring them over. And before that, he would tell all the people that worked for him, they all had a fanny pack. And in the fanny pack, there was drugs. There was ecstasy pills. There was cocaine. And it was a GHB or whatever the fuck that shit is. And it was all the date rape drugs. And it was all in their fanny packs. And that before they invited people, he would tell the maids and shit to go to the Ciroc bottles, the vodka bottles, to the fucking Don Julio's, and to all the bottles and fucking throw ecstasy pills inside of them and shake them. The ecstasy pills fucking dissolve in the fucking alcohol, and then the whole alcohol is laced with ecstasy. And then this guy would bring sex workers, and that because they would force him to drink, that he would get all drugged, and then he would have to be like, he would force him to participate. I don't know how you force somebody to participate in orgies and sexual acts. According to Rod Jones, he was forced to partake in this kinds of activities. He also said that during his time working with Puff Daddy, apparently, he was being groomed. Because every time he would go and fucking, he would go and be with Puff Daddy or whatever, apparently, Puff Daddy, he would pass by and Puff Daddy would squeeze his ass or grab his crotch and shit. Like, good job. And he would go like that with his finger up his ass and shit. And this guy was all like, what the fuck? And he would complain to the other assistants, and the assistants was all like, no, that's a good thing. That just means he likes you. It's like, done up thing. He's playing around. He likes you. He does this with his friends. He likes you a lot. He considers you a friend. It's okay. That's the kind of shit that was going on. It got even worse because when he would bring his friends over, one of the celebrity friends that he mentions was Cuba Gooding Jr. He says, because Puff Daddy had been grabbing my ass, poking my ass with his finger and squeezing my balls for months now, I guess I did get accustomed to it. And so when Cuba Gooding Jr. came out, Cuba Jr. says, this is your boy. Oh, how's it going? Cuba Gooding Jr. grab a handful of my balls, tickling my asshole and shit. And he always like, this motherfucker, he's just trying to loan me out to his friends. These are some pretty crazy accusations, my friends. Is Puff Daddy capable of this? Yes, of course he is. The reasoning, I don't know. People are asking, how can somebody do this? Somebody, in my opinion, who has that much money gets bored really, really quickly. Especially when he has access. He's a celebrity and he has access to everything he could ever want and shit. Because you're online with Beelzebub and the devil and all that ass. Whatever the fuck you want to call it. Look, it's probably true. That's my opinion. It probably is true, he's not the only one. They all do it. All of them. And the only reason why all the motherfuckers haven't gotten caught is because everyone else around them likes that kind of shit. They, unfortunately, Puff Daddy went and hired the wrong motherfucker to make songs for him, and this guy wasn't into it. I mean, the moment the guy was like, I don't like this. All right, well, then go home and you're fired. That would have been my fucking shit, Let me get another motherfucker. Let me go to the strip club and find a fucking pervert to come work for me so he can be a pervert with me. I mean, if I was Puff Daddy, that's what I would have done. But I'm not Puff Daddy, so I don't do that kind of debaucherous shit. I'm just saying. All right. Yeah, I think he did it all. Super Saiyan Goku says it. And I believe it too. I mean, whatever. Things come to light. If you force someone to do something they don't want to do just because you have money, this is a new woke culture. You're going to get busted. All right. Things will come out. Nothing that is secret won't come out to light and shit. Tom Hanks, son of a bitch. You're going to get caught one of these days. Anyways, let's move on from the ass, the literal ass. And we're going into more celebrity stuff. And guess what? None other than the Real Housewives, Leah McSweeney, is now suing Andy Cohen and Bravo. I don't know if she's suing Bravo, but she's definitely suing this motherfucker who is the head of the fucking show and created these fucking stupid-ass shows that all these women make. He's a smart motherfucker. He makes a lot of money, is all I'm saying. He may be gay, and that's fine, but he makes a lot of money. Respect him for that, sons of bitches. He came up with the idea of putting all these rich bitches together and, according to her, getting them drunk and high and then filming them caused drama in each other's lives because they're on drugs and they're drunk. According to this woman who is suing him, this motherfucker would fucking get them drunk way before the show even started filming and encourage them to get drunk. It was like fucking... She's like, it was fucking 8 in the morning. This motherfucker's like, champagne, everybody! He's giving them all champagne. They're all getting drunk. Let's start filming once they're fucking shit-faced. And then the black women start fighting with the white women. And that's the kind of shit that this guy filmed. And she's saying he made this toxic environment on purpose for all of us. And some of us were alcoholics. I hadn't been drinking for 9 months. And I got on this show and he turned me fucking, you know, I started fucking all these guys because I was drunk. And my husband got mad and divorced me. So she's all mad and shit. And she's suing him now. All right. She's also claiming this guy would walk around with cocaine and all the assistants and everyone in the crew to the cameraman just pouring it out. Everybody, you want a line? Here you go. Put your hands out. And you want some too? All right. And give everybody. And the girls from the show who would do cocaine with him would get more screen time. She says, I didn't do cocaine. I'm skinny because I work out and I have a good diet, but I never did cocaine like they did, she says. But the girls who did cocaine with him, they got more screen time because they were his little cocaine buddies. And so now she's trying to sue the shit out of him because of this. Yeah, I don't doubt it, you know, but this chick is a this chick is a hypocrite. Because she indulged in all these activities and now she wants to sue because what? You're not a movie star? You run out of money? Your husband divorced you or whatever the fuck? Fuck you! If you took part in it, then you knew what you were doing. Hey, I hate fucking lawsuits like this. I hate celebrities like this. Oh, I was drunk and then I used to be an alcoholic and then they brought the dark side out of me again. No, fuck you. You know exactly, if you're an alcoholic and you've been sober for 9 months, you know exactly what you're doing when you take that beer and someone gives it to you. If you've been sober for 9 months and someone says you want a beer, then you say, sure, you want to get drunk. Fuck you. You've been miserable those 9 months and you want to have some fun. You know exactly what you're doing. Fuck her. I'm with Andy Cohen here. It's probably true. I'm not going to lie. This is the Real Housewives. I mean, I probably watched like half an episode and I could tell those bitches were either on drugs or drunk. I mean, they're rich as fuck. I would too. If I was a woman and my husband was rich as fuck and I stayed home all day, I'd be drunk and on drugs all day long and I'd have all my friends over and we'd be over here just fighting and being bitches. That's how it would be. And that's just me. So goddamn well, this is what's going on. And she partook in it. Fuck her for trying to, you know, fucking say, oh, you know, they fucking did this to me. You fucking knew what you were doing when you signed up for the fucking show, you dumb bitch. Cheers to fucking Andy Cohen. I like this motherfucking guy, all right? You can do your cocaine and feed these women alcohol. As long as you don't rape them, there's nothing wrong with that, all right? Don't do what Diddy does, all right? There's nothing wrong with getting women all loaded up so they can have fun. Girls just wanna have fun. That's all I gotta say. Cheers! Guess what, guys? Carmen Electra is officially named Carmen Electra. Now, hold on. I know it sounds crazy, but her real name is actually Tara Leigh Patrick. Well, she finally, after all these years, after all these 65 years, she's been alive. I don't know how old she is. She looks like she's 65. Not in that picture with the oh my god, with the angel feathers. Yeah. Anyways, Charlie Sheen, you fucking bastard. That's all I'm gonna say. Yeah. Anyways, yes. She finally went to a judge and asked to have her name changed to Carmen Electra. Gotta pick this up. I didn't even know her real name was Tara Leigh Patrick. Now that I think about it, I had no idea why I even believed her last name was Electra. I think I might have been distracted by something. For me to fucking even think Electra doesn't sound like a real last name. I always thought, for whatever reason, that was her real name. No, yep. I'll tell you one thing. Madonna didn't never look like this, which is why I always knew Madonna's fucking name is not Madonna. The bitch. Yeah. Cheers to Carmen Electra, who is finally Carmen Electra. Oh, my God. Yeah. Mm. Cheers. Some disappointing news, according to the haters, as I like to call them. But disappointing news, the haters are saying that J-Lo's brand new album, This Is Me Now, which also premiered with a brand new movie, which is called The Greatest, The Greatest Love Story Ever Told, or some ass, which is supposed to be like a movie with dancing and singing with the songs of her album, kind of like Michael Jackson did and shit. Prince and shit, Purple Rain, something like that. But some kind of like her struggle with love and finally ending up with Ben Affleck or some ass like that. You know, something like that. Ben Affleck wasn't happy with it, but then he says, I am happy because I just remember how good your ass is when I'm inside of it. So yes, I support you with this. But according to the haters, this is a big flop. And the reason, according to them, that this is a big flop is because it has debuted at number 38 on the Billboard charts. Now, I'll give you some perspective. About 10 years ago, her last album debuted at number 12 on the Billboard charts. And then 20 years ago, her first album debuted at number 1. So she has gone from number 1 to number 12 to now number 38 on her new album. How is that a failure? I am not on the Billboard charts. I never debuted on the fucking Billboard charts. The fucking haters want to come out and trash this woman because her album is at number 38 on the Billboard. She made it on the goddamn charts. There's thousands, if not millions, of artists that don't even chart at all. Not even the top 100. God damn it. And people want to trash her. Yeah, she's no fucking Billie Eilish or I don't know who else. Camila Cabello or what. I don't know what people listen to nowadays. This little Miley Cyrus. What was the other little girl's name? Yeah, she's none of those right now. It doesn't matter. 38 to me is still good out of millions of motherfuckers out there trying to fucking put something out. And When the fuck was the last time Madonna charted at 38 and shit? You know what I'm saying? So fuck you to all the haters. And I'm going to say cheers to J-Lo and her 52-year-old fine ass. Cheers, J-Lo. Mm. And I got to say cheers to DJ New Kid. Cheers, motherfucker. We're glad you're here again. We appreciate you, DJ New Kid. You keep this up, you might end up a Woke Pack member with an intro and shit. Oh, yeah. Cheers, New Kid. You're the shit, motherfucker. Mm. All right. We're almost done with the celebrity breakdown. But, of course, we cannot end celebrities without talking about the Yeezy. And this week, he was in Paris, France. And they wore all black. He covered his face again with his mask and shit. And she wasn't nude, but she was with a rubber trench coat. She probably was nude underneath it. Hey, you know what? Cheers for being at work. I'm sorry. Do you need DJ New Kid? Just say cheers for being at work. Oh, man. That's badass. Thank you for watching or listening at work. I hope you don't get in trouble. All right. No, fucking get somebody gonna walk in. And there's a fucking guy with some makeup going, fuck you. Yeah, you might get in trouble for that, dude. Be careful. Anyways, yay, war. And he's a genius for this. Some kind of like tape or some kind of reflective material on his clothes. So every time somebody took a picture, this is the way the pictures were coming out. If you took a picture without the flash, you wouldn't get that. But yeah, I was like, this motherfucker, it is a genius. Genius. And I'll tell you why he's a genius. Because no one's ever thought of that. Let's make some clothes where his motherfuckers take pictures of you. You're going to fucking glow. Oh my God. That is so fucking smart and innovating, man. Because I would have never have thought of that. This is badass. Maybe not specifically this that he has on, but that idea, man. This guy, I hope he patents that shit because he could make so much money. Because, God damn it, clothes like that would be badass. Like, you fucking go out in public and let's take a selfie and you take it and you're fucking glowing, dude, because of the flash. That's badass, bro. If you do it different colors, I wonder if it would glow a different fucking color. That's fucking badass. Cheers to Yeze and always making fashion interesting. I just tell you like that. Innovating. But we're not done. Because speaking of innovations, he took his wife out all over Paris. And of course, they had to push the envelope. First, they went out with like the tiniest little bra bikini on and shit. And her titties look heavy as fuck. Oh my God, yay. And they're natural too. Yay, you're fucking awesome. She probably just lays those down right on your face, bro. That's awesome. But then the second night he took her out in hosiery and some heels. She's wearing a fucking, you know, furry coat or whatever to cover. Probably she's probably nude. Her titties doesn't have a bra on, but she has a coat covering, a furry coat. But she's wearing hosiery with no underwear. It's censored. And I'm sorry, y'all. I tried to get you all the uncensored. I looked everywhere. I don't know why they're not out there. But everyone saw her cooch and her asshole. Wow. In Paris. This is insane. And there are people in Paris that are demanding for her to either go to jail or get fined for exposing herself like this in public. Because if anybody in Paris or anybody in the world would walk around like this, I'm pretty sure you would end up in jail. Now, I will say I am from Texas, down here in the South. And I will say this, if you go to the Capitol in Austin, Texas, that's way farther south than me. Topless women are allowed. Now, there may be some establishments that may say, oh, we don't allow that. You have to go somewhere else. But a topless woman cannot get arrested. And I did not believe that until I was downtown on a Sunday afternoon. About to go eat something at a bar. I said, let me go at a bar. I'll have some chips or some whatever food they serve and I'll drink. It'll be badass on a Sunday afternoon. And walking down downtown in the street, there is a woman with a fucking long pink scarf. I'll never forget this image. I'll never forget. It was a woman wearing sandals, but the sandals that were heels. I'm very descriptive, especially when I remember shit. The sandals that were heels and pumps like that. It was a nice, breezy spring afternoon, Sunday afternoon. And she was wearing pumps and her heels were up like that. And she was wearing a long pink skirt. Long, covering all her legs, Well, the only thing you could see is her feet. She's walking. She was wearing a hat. It was a big hat. It was wide and big. It was almost like a straw hat. It was yellow. Fancy. Very beautiful woman. Blonde hair. Blue eyes. Pale, milky, white skin. But she wasn't wearing a shirt or a bra. And she was walking down the street with her purse and her hat. She walked past by two police officers and a bunch of other people, and even me, who just stopped and went like this. That just happened. And yeah, so it's legal down there. But this is another fucking level, bro. You're seeing these women's orifices. And people online are saying, what is wrong with him? Somebody go save her. Look, it's like that guy in the comments says, she wants to do this. She is happy to do this. And if she is happy to do this for people in public, Ye is having the time of his life when they are in private. Cheers! But this isn't the end of the Yeezy news. Because Yeezy went on Instagram and started fucking going after Kim Kardashian. Shit. He said, Kim, you better take my kids out of the Sierra Canyon school. Because it's fake. It's a fake school for celebrities that are used by the system. And he put, at this point, everybody knows what the system is code for. I know what he's talking about, but if I say it, I'm going to sound like the racist. But it's the people that are killing Palestinians right now. That's what Yeezy is referring to. People who are killing Palestinians right now. It's cold work for the system. He goes, I was removed from my dad by the system, and the system removed me from my children. When the system drafts athletes, they avoid working with those who have their father in their life because they are harder to manipulate. My two oldest know their daddy, who their daddy is. Their daddy is a god who's worth $400 million and is the Yeezy, the most enigmatic performer, artist that's ever existed. So fuck you, the system, coming after the Yeezy and his kids, trying to fucking fuck his family. Look, I'll tell you like this. His oldest kids, the two oldest, their minds are free and they fucking know what's going on. But the other ones, the younger ones, the other two, they belong to the system, for sure. But you could tell Yeezy for sure on the two oldest ones, because he goes to everything they do. He's right there in their lives. But the little ones, I don't think Kim is allowing him so much time with the little ones, because the bigger ones are older and they say, I want to be with dad. Oh no, I'm going to set the couch on fire, bitch. And they set the couch. Fine, go with your dad. And they go with their dads. But the little ones, I think they're already lost. But Yeezy knows that. It sucks, man, when your relationship's like that. The Mossad, yeah, it is all that. I believe it, dude, it is. And it's sad, because the sad part is that they hide behind this fucking religion that they don't even follow. And because of them, the faith is being fucking, somebody's faith is being fucking shitted on. You know, and I know Yeezy, because he doesn't know how to express himself. He doesn't mean these people with this faith, because they're not a race. Let's be honest. It's a faith. These people with this faith, it's not them who are doing this. It's these motherfuckers, the Mossad, who hide behind this faith that they don't even follow. These motherfuckers just want control of the world. And because they have already infiltrated every aspect of fucking human life, they basically do own the world. And unless you're aligned with them, you this is what happens to you. What's happening to Yeezy. Yeezy, unfortunately, doesn't know how to express himself, and that's why everybody thinks he's crazy. It's not his fault. He didn't go to college. Neither did I, but oh well. Yay-zay, we do love you in this channel, and we support you and your kids and everything you do. You know, because up until now, you haven't done any shameful, like, rape women or molest children or anything crazy like some of these other celebrities that are now being brought to life and all these fucking disasters and shit. People say you're crazy, but you know what? People think I'm crazy. My own family might think I'm fucking crazy. You know, look at me. All right. Oh, we're normal compared to the rest of the world. That's all I'll say like that. Because the rest of the world is fucked up. If they want to follow a system or a fucking world that tells them how they should act or behave, or this is what you, fuck you. I know who I am because I know when I was born who the fuck I was. Fuck you. You know what I'm saying? I'll just put it like that. But yeah. Cheers to Yeezy. And cheers to all you out there, motherfuckers. Cheers. Alright, we're done with the goddamn celebrity breakdown. Opening a brand new beer. And we get this show on the road. Because we are about to start the goddamn comic book nerd shit. Comic book nerd shit. And I want to get the ass out of the way right away. I don't want to fucking waste time because I know this is probably annoying to a lot of people. I don't know where I left my one hitter, but I'm going to use this one. Halo Episode 5. Let me get out of the way and I'll try to be as quick as possible. I have the best parts, the only best parts of the fucking episode showing, and it's not a lot. The last episode was really fucking good, and I expected this one to be a continuation of the last one, and unfortunately, the continuation of the last one only lasted like 10 minutes in the beginning. And then there were some interesting parts, and they, like I said, I'm only showing the good parts. There were some interesting parts sprinkled in the middle, and then at the very end. But let me just go over what happened in the episode, because it sucked ass. There's more story. That it was stuff that I don't know. They should have just continued from the first season, and they jumped around, and I don't know what they're doing right now. This is episode 5. There's only 3 left, which is what's pissing me off. They finally introduced the Arbiter. Now, people will argue that this might not be the Arbiter from the fucking TV show. But they finally did introduce the Arbiter. He looks badass. I don't know, fellas, the special effects to me still fucking seem a little bit downgraded. In the beginning, they fight one of the brutes, and he just looks really fucking fake to me. He looks like the lighting is not right, where he looks like he's not really part of the scene. And that's what's wrong here. I don't know what they're using. I don't know if this is, they should try using Unreal Engine 5. People seem to look that more real in that than they do in this. I'm just saying, like, the special effects last season looked better than they do in this season. So I don't know if they downgraded the budget or what, but the Arbiter and they don't look like they're even there in the scene. They look separate from it. And that takes away from me. But basically, in the store, most of the story is Master Chief trying to deal with loss and the acceptance of loss because he's a robot. And now that he feels, he doesn't understand because his friend, I keep forgetting what this guy is, Vennik. I think his name is Vennik. He fucking died. The Black Spartan, he died. And he doesn't know how, you know, he says that's a dead body. And Quan wants to bury him. And he's all like, well, he's just a dead body. Why are we burying a dead body? And he goes, you don't understand. It's because that memory of him is going to stay with you forever. You need to actually bury him and let go of your emotions so that you can move on. And he kind of learns that. He figures it out and he learns that. And that's really what the episode is. In between that, they sprinkled that fucking this little girl, McKee, is with the Arbiter, and the Arbiter is gonna take her back to the fucking mushroom cloud, or I forget what this place is called, the Covenant, and she's taking him back, so you know he's taking her back so that she can be judged because they failed in their mission. And this is exactly what it was in the Halo, where he failed in his mission. He goes back and he can't go back until, you know, he fucking accomplishes, you know, he's basically chastised from them royally, because it was a whole ceremony, but they chastised him and he can't come back until he fucking finishes what he's supposed to do or dies in the process and shit, some shit like that. They don't explain any of that. I don't know if they're following the story from the game and shit. They don't explain any of that. But this is what's basically going on. And McKee tricks him because she doesn't want to go back and get killed, because they're going to kill her as soon as she goes back and shit. But she doesn't want to die, and so she's trying to convince him. And all of a sudden, Cortana projects, because, you know, McKee stole Cortana. I forgot. I'm getting too ahead, because I'm trying to fast forward through this. I don't want to talk about this too much. But basically, she had Cortana, and she tried to talk to Cortana, and Cortana's like, I'm AI, but you don't know how to use me, and you can't control me. I belong to Master Chief. Fuck you. And she disappears. But I guess Cortana is there, and she realizes that this little girl is going to get killed, but maybe Cortana knows she's useful, because she's going to help us find the Halo ring. And so then Cortana suddenly fucking projects the Halo ring from the images of Master Chief's mind. And the Arbiter freaks out and tells McKee, how are you doing this? And McKee right there realizes Cortana's doing it, but this motherfucker doesn't know what AI is. And he tells the Arbiter, hey, this isn't me. This is prophecy. These are the gods telling you that you're destined for this, and you need to listen to me and not to them, the Covenant. And so this idiot believes her. And he goes, you know they're going to kill us both. If they're going to send everything after us, and they're going to kill us both. And she's all like, yeah, but you have to follow us. You have to follow me, because the gods are showing you. This is destiny. And so he believes her, and he turns the ship around, and they leave. So, yeah. And then Cortana shows up in front of McKee and nods to her, like saying, I did this, and you know I did this. Like, I'm helping you. So Cortana is going to play both sides in order to get back to Master Chief. This is cool, but this was like 5 minutes out of an hour, which is why I'm saying why the episode sucks. I'm showing you the good parts, and the good part in the beginning where they fight the brute is like 10 minutes. This scene is probably 5 minutes, and the ending, which is badass, is probably like a minute and a half. During the episode, they tell Master Chief that fucking Kai is dead. I love this character. I love Kai. She's sexy as fuck. She's a big Amazonian woman. I love it. That's everything I like. I like a woman to be bigger than me. It's badass. I mean, you have no idea how fun that is. This is great. But then we see, they tell Master Chief that she died with Vanek and everybody over there. And fucking, I think, oh yeah, I forgot to tell you that Riz decides to just be a normal commoner. She doesn't want to be a Spartan anymore because she's damaged. She's limping and shit. She can't even stand. And so they leave her behind, and she stays to be a normal person from now on. Just like the blind guy in the previous episode had told her. But yes, Kai is alive, and she's aligned herself with Eckerson. And not only that, but he's put her in charge of the whole army. So she says Master Chief is not Master Chief anymore. He's defective, and he's not good for the fucking USSR or whatever they're called. And so he puts her in charge of the armies, and she's basically the new Master Chief and the face of fucking, you know, the face of the United States Armada, or whatever the fuck they are. I forget what they're called and shit. And that's basically episode 5. Episode 5 is basically the only good parts, is what I'm showing you, which combine probably equals to like 16 minutes out of the hour episode. Because the rest of it is bullshit that is following, I don't know what they're doing. Quan is having visions, and people are disappearing and appearing. Master Chief is having emotions, and she... Fuck you! That YouTube show that fan did where it's just literally the Spartans on a mission. That's what this should have been. There's good things in this. There really are. And I'm showing you the good things and I explained the good things. But when you watch it for an hour and there's only like 16 minutes of good things, it really disappoints me, man. It really disappoints me where I thought the fucking first season had 10 episodes. And out of the 10 episodes, 3, I would say, are you don't even have to watch them. So that leaves you with 7 episodes that was good. And I still consider that a win. But this has been trash from the beginning. 3 episodes, man. And they're not going to get to the Halo ring at all. They're not. I doubt it. They're not going to get to the Halo ring. They're not. I don't know. They're finally starting to go into plot points from the first season. But I don't know if it's going to satisfy me. Because it's been 5 episodes already. And these aren't 10 episodes. This is only 8. But I'm done ranting about Halo. I'm done. And since I'm done, I got to give it up for our number one moderator and our OG Woke Pack member, Gomer Kyle, who showed up. And sorry, Gomer, I didn't want to ruin my train of thought. But as soon as I end it, I'll get it up for you. Gomer Kyle, here we go for you. Thank you for being here.
What's your name, scumbag?
Gomer Pyle.
Private Pyle, I'm going to give you 3 seconds. To wipe that stupid-looking grin off your face, or I will gouge out your eyeballs and skull-fuck you! 1, 2, 3!
Shazam!
Cheers, fucking Gomer! And I gotta tell you right away, BBW for live! Hell yeah, bro! You need more cushion for the pushing. That's all I'm gonna say. It feels a lot better. A million times better than the skinny chick. Cheers, Gomer. We love you. Thank you for being here. I was worried, Gomer. I thought something bad had happened to you. I'm glad you're here, motherfucker. It worried me because, you know, Gomer and Joku and Cunt are usually the first guys. Cunt, I know you, man. You live in Australia, so, motherfucker, it's like early in the morning. So if you've had a wild night, I understand. That's not a big deal. And like I've told you guys during the break, If you all miss, you go do your thing, bros. Everybody has a life, you know, and sometimes we have shit to do on a Friday night. I will, as long as you guys show up and as long as people subscribe and people watch the videos, you know, I get comments, I will do my very best to always be here every Friday night. That's my promise. Cheers to you guys. Gomer, cheers to you. I'm glad you're good, bum, motherfucker, and thank you for joining us. You should watch the rest of the show and shit earlier. I thought we talk about you. We love you. All right, let's keep going with the comic book nerd shit. We're done with the Halo ass. But we got our very first look, because I guess they're filming this, of Bill Skarsgård as the Crow. I'm taking a hit right now. Look, I want to get into it in depth. But before that, let's do a comparison of Brandon Lee's take and Skarsgård. Now, this is all has to do with the director. Obviously, the director chose this look. He probably got a lot of concept art and a lot of different looks and artists and shit, and this is what he thought it was best. I like it. I know what a lot of people are going to say, and I'll get to it right now in a minute. But I'm showing you the comparisons. This was back in the early 90s, and this is fucking almost maybe 30 years later. You know what I'm saying? 30 years later. The culture is different. And to be perfectly honest with you, Gomer, you should watch the show because we talked about wrestling earlier. You know, later on when I repost this Saturday. But, like I'm getting to, with all honesty, Sting overplayed it already throughout a better part of the last 20 years. That if they would have done the exact same thing, it would have been meh. It would have been. I get it. I honestly do get it. He might resemble the Joker from Jared Leto's Suicide Squad. Maybe, but it's not quite. I think he looks creepy as fuck. Skarsgård already looks creepy as fuck. He does. Skarsgård is one. The Skarsgårds, I'll put it like that. All of them. Even the one who's not that famous. I think all of them are really good actors. I think the one who's not that famous has the really wrong... what are these called? Agents. He has the wrong agent who is getting him the wrong roles. That's how he's fucking up. But I think all three of them are really, really good. They come from a good family that's got acting genes. Because as far as performance-wise, what they're given, they fucking do their best that they can. I like this. This is what somebody nowadays, at this man's age, these are the type of tattoos this motherfucker probably would have. Now, is he... what's the story? If it's going to be the same story, what's his background is going to be? Is he just fucking a punk? When this guy in the band? Or is he just, like this motherfucking menace? I don't know how much the story is going to change as far as like what's going to happen. And whether or not they're going to go as far as what the Crow happened, because if we all remember, they pretty much raped that girl and killed him, and well, actually raped her in front of him and then killed her and shit. So all this shit went down. Are they going to go that far? Because nowadays the culture might not be, acceptance of that kind of fucking the stuff on shown on screen. So, I don't know. They changed it this much, which I expected it. I keep telling you guys, I really, really, really did not expect them to go back and do this exactly the same. I didn't expect it to look like this. I didn't think they were going to do the white face anymore. I really did not. I really didn't think he was going to be covered all in black, looking like bandages. No, I was like, that's not what they're going to do. And if they do the white face with the sting, I was not going to like it, because it's not what it is nowadays. It's not. I'm not mad about this. I want to see the trailer, and I want to see how much of the story they're going to change, because I promise you, the story is probably going to change. It is. Yeah. That's interesting that you say that, Gomer. That he can only do horror movies or remakes. That's interesting that you say that. I think he's got potential where, because obviously this is the type of role he's going to be getting. I can see him as a Bond villain someday. He's got a very interesting face, man. Like him, Remy Malek, like Mads Mikkelsen, motherfuckers like that, Cillian Murphy. Those motherfuckers have interesting faces where obviously you can right away cast him as a villain or some sick psychopath or something like that. But then you get to the age where Cillian Murphy has proven himself, where it's like, yes, but my range is more than that. And then you see him in Oppenheimer and shit. This is that kind of actor. This is the kind of guy who, yes, he's going to get this type of stereotypical roles, but at the end of the day, he is going to fucking prove to everybody that he has it in him to fucking to be anything. And I can see it in his acting. I think Skarsgård is a good actor, that I think he can be anything. And it's only like as he gets older, I think you'll see that transition. But right now, this is the type of film he is going to continue to keep getting. I'm not mad about the way he looks. I think he looks badass, believe it or not. I do. This is better than Joker. This is way better. If the Joker looked like this, it would have been better. Instead of green. If you take away you add green hair and the red fucking lips, then it's the Joker. And then it would look shitty. Because I don't want the Joker looking like that. But this is not the Joker, because there's no green hair and no red lips. This is some psycho fucking crazy guy who maybe has a punk band or something. You know? Because that's what motherfuckers like. I've seen motherfuckers, you know, yeah, I live in Texas, and there's motherfuckers like this. They got their face tattooed, and I've seen women with their face forehead tattoos and shit. I have. So, I know there's motherfuckers like that, and that's what this guy is. I'm just curious to see what the fucking story is gonna be. Curry, Tim Curry is the best Pennywise, of course, hands down. Tim Curry is also the best transsexual vampire or from fucking Transylvania. that guy was badass, and he was also the devil in fucking, what was it called, that movie with Tom Cruise, Legend. Damn, he's been in Home Alone. Tim Curry's the shit. Curry was the shit. Is the shit. His face. Tim Curry is this type of actor. You know what I'm saying? Where it's all like, that motherfucker was always cast as a fucking bad guy and shit. Or sinister sleazeball. Because of his face. But, you know, he had good range. And the Skarsgårds, all three of them, they have good range. And I think this guy's gonna kill it. Even if they give him a shitty script, I think this guy will make the movie good. I'm just saying. I'll still wait. I'm a little bit reserved, and we'll wait to see the trailer. But that's just my opinion. I am happy with this. I'm not upset with it. I think it looks badass. Hot as fuck. I'm gonna say it right now. This guy could be on the cover of Rolling Stone next week, for sure, looking like this. Fuck yeah. Cheers! Bill Skarsgård, crazy looking motherfucker. But going on to other news, this week it was announced that apparently the director from Shang-Chi, I forget his name, Din Lin or some ass, I don't know. He will now bring to life Naruto. For live action, for Lionsgate. Look, before I even talk about this, I'm going to tell you my experience with Naruto. Because I know this has a huge following. I have literally only seen one fucking episode of Naruto. The episode I saw, they looked younger than this picture I have here. So I'm guessing because it's been going on for a long time, I think. I think it's been at least 10 years since this shit's been going on. Or more, I don't know. I'm not a fan. But I've only seen one episode, and the episode I saw was a long time ago. And the main kid, which is the guy in the middle, Naruto, I think that's him. He was a lot young. He looked a lot younger, drawn, you know. And in that episode, he fought this kid who wore a mask that had no expression and had red hair. And the only thing I could understand, because I only saw one episode, the only thing I could understand is that they all belong to some kind of school that is teaching these kids how to use their powers. That's what I got from it. I might be wrong. But in that episode, he had to fight this kid who was wearing a mask with no expressions and had red hair. And I guess they all have different powers. I don't quite understand Naruto's powers, except that he's really good at fighting. And there's a fox or some shit. But this other kid's powers was that he controlled sand. And the animation was so badass. And the fight scene where he fought this kid that controlled sand was so amazing. I can honestly tell you it looked better than Dragon Ball Z. And I was just like, wow, this is cool, or whatever. But I never got into it, and I never saw anything else besides that one episode. So for all I know, that might have been the only good episode that I got to see. I don't know. But this guy's bringing it to life, and this thing is supposed to be some big fucking thing. The cunt says that this Naruto is ass, is what he says. Like I said, I only know one episode. That episode was kind of cool. I don't know nothing about this at all. I don't know, because obviously, like I said, the episode I saw, he seemed younger. He looks older in this picture that I nabbed from the internet. I don't know what this guy is going to adapt. And if you're a fan and you're excited about it, that's cool. I don't know. I think I just, like everything else that I know nothing about, I'm just going to wait till the fucking trailer to make my fucking... I might watch this, I might not. I mean, most of the time, I don't watch anything unless it's something I'm really passionate about. I don't pay for it. We don't pay for ass on this channel, not what we can get it for free. Windscribe VPN. Cheers. But we're done with Naruto, because I don't know shit about it. But one shit I do know a lot about, and everyone else knows, Godzilla Minus One. The director of this franchise, Takashi Yamaka. Damn it. Yamazaki. Takashi Yamazaki. These are hard names, all right? They're like him trying to say fucking Arnold Jones and shit. It's hard for him. It's hard for me. All right? That's what it is. He has been asked several questions because obviously this is a fucking hit. And I can't wait till it's on digital so I can download it with the dubs. Or at least the subtitles. I want to see it in good quality. Should have come out already. It's fucking March. I don't know why this movie hasn't come out on digital already. But we're waiting for it. But he's been getting a lot of questions because this movie was on a $10 to $15 million budget, which is nothing nowadays. And it made well over $100 million worldwide. That's a big success. For anybody who spends a dime and gets a dollar back, fuck you, that's a big success. Fuck you, Marvel. You spend fucking $20 and you couldn't even get your fucking $100 back. You did it, you pussies. These motherfuckers made a lot of money with chump change. I'll just say it like that. They've been asking him, when he's gonna direct? Is he ready? Is he already written the second one? Is the fucking, this coming down? When the fuck? This is a hit. And he said, all right, everybody calm the fuck down. All right. I'm working on another movie right now. I'm pretty sure the way it's going, we're probably going to get green lit for a second one. At the moment, I am working on another movie, so it's not going to happen next year. And I haven't been told anything. And he goes, but I'm pretty sure because of the way things are going, it's going to happen. And because of that, I have some ideas. And according to this man, he says, for the part two, I want a kaiju fight. I don't want Godzilla by himself destroying shit. And the humans trying to figure out. That's it. It's time to bring in kaijus and have a kaiju fight. And he goes, I will admit, it's going to be hard to write a compelling human story. Because even though Godzilla was in the movie a lot, and he is a big part of the movie, the whole movie revolves around a human story about a kamikaze deserter who deserted. He didn't go and kill himself. And he wants to regain his honor in some way, you know, because he feels like he let his country down. And the way they show how people felt after Japan lost a war, that the Japanese were actually angry and bitter, and they fucking, you know, because this guy abandoned the kamikazes, they fucking blame, you know, fuck you, it's because of you, because you deserted the fucking army. So he's just trying to regain his honor. So there's a human story to it. And I liked it a lot, the human story to it, which made the movie. Because it would have just been Godzilla killing everything, it would have made no sense. But the human story in this one is better than the Americans, because it's more emotional and shit, that's all I'm going to say. So this guy says it is going to be hard to make a movie where two monsters are fighting and make an emotional human story. But that's for me to tackle. And that's what I'm going to try to do. I think it's obvious what's going to happen. And I can't wait for it. Because this first movie, I don't know if you all saw it. This first movie is amazing. I recommend all you motherfuckers to go fucking watch it as soon as it comes out on digital. It has to be soon, this month. For fuck's sake, it's March already. But this is obvious. The first one is a literal retelling of the 1954 one and shit, with stuff borrowed from the newer movies inserted into it to make it even more better and realistic. But it's basically a retelling of that during World War II. It's a retelling of that. And if they're gonna do a, if he's gonna do a sequel and he wants a kaiju fight, then it's only obvious he should do a retelling of the second Godzilla movie, which is Godzilla Raids Again, and we get him to fight Anguirus. Finally get a decent looking Anguirus in modern times. I'm not gonna lie, Anguirus is my favorite kaiju growing up as a kid. Because to me, I thought as a kid, I liked turtles, and as a kid, I think we had a pet turtle. I vaguely remember it. I must have been really young before it died, probably because, you know, my family didn't know how to take care of animals growing up. But I can't blame them for that. They just come from another place and were taught differently. But yes, our pet turtle died, and I always thought this kaiju was like my pet turtle. So I liked Anguirus. And I would love it if Godzilla Minus One Part Two, I don't know if it's going to be called Godzilla Minus Two, whatever the fuck they call it, I hope it's Anguirus in this kaiju fight that this motherfucker, because this is what I feel they're doing, is you're just rebooting the original franchise and starting from the very beginning. And you did the first one perfect. Everyone's praising you. So just readapt the second one and do it perfect. In the same manner, in the same style, the same CGI effects. Make it for $10 million and make $200 million out of it. Make $1 billion. It doesn't matter. Just, if you put American actors, you probably make more money, you dumbass. That's how you're fucking up. You're making good movies. Put fucking Tom Cruise in this fucking movie. It's gonna make a lot of money. That's all I'm saying. He could be the only American in it. Everybody's speaking Japanese. Tom Cruise will learn Japanese and do the movie in Japanese. That's how badass he is. That's his stunt for the movie. He learns Japanese so he can be in this. Fuck yeah. Tom Cruise, Godzilla Minus 2, coming to you in the theaters 2 years from now. Cheers. All right. We're going to move on. Let me take another hit. Cheers, Gomer Kyle, the cunt, all you motherfuckers out there. Thank you for being here tonight on a Friday night. Mary Jane. Aw, yeah. All right. We're moving on to some DC ass. And this week was Superman's birthday. I believe it was his 85th or 6th birthday. I don't remember. But it was expected of James Gunn to spoil something or give us something. And he gave us a picture of Superman's suit. Only the S, which he had already teased last time, or it was spoiled by that little hawk girl unintentionally. And it was the S, and it was shown, and now he showed the S from the suit. And thank God it wasn't silver, like in that image. Like I said, thank God that was just them cutting corners. Let's just give him a plaque with the image. It could be all silver. Who gives a fuck? I love, and I can't say this enough, I love that this suit is going to have yellow. Yellow. I love that it will have yellow. Yeah, Gomer, it was a Batman's 85. It was weird that fucking it was a week apart. Ah, it was fucking weird. Batman's birthday was last week, and then this week is Superman's. Yeah, they're about to go to public use, and everybody's gonna make porn and crazy movies of them. DC's fucked. But James Gunn posted this on Instagram on Superman's birthday, and he posted, "When I finished the first draft of the script, I called it Superman Legacy. By the time I locked the final draft, it was clear that the title was Superman. Mostly because probably James Gunn, a dumbass, probably for the for the first time in his life, realized that the original movie was called Superman the Movie. And so Superman, as a title movie, had never been used. So he took advantage of it. He says, so Superman, now titled just plainly Superman, is making its way to you July 2025. And during his threads, and I just learned what a thread was, because I didn't know what the fuck. I mean, there was Facebook, and then there was Instagram, and then there was TikTok, and then there was, and then there was Twitter, and then there was TikTok, and then Facebook bought Instagram, and they became Meta, but now Meta has made threads, which is their version of Twitter. Which I didn't even know existed till this week. Anyways, I fucking hate the internet sometimes. On his threads, this guy has gone posted some more, and he said that corn sweat was the reason there's snow on this is because this guy was wearing the suit in his underwear, which sounds weird when you read the thread. I don't have it here, but it says, corn sweet, I posted this picture, but I should have. She goes, you're lucky I didn't post you doing snow angels in the snow in your underwear. Now, everybody on the internet is thinking that David Corn Sweat was naked in his underwear, went outside, and was doing snow angels. To be a badass or a comic guy or just everybody thinks that's what James Gunn is talking about. I think James Gunn just gave us a huge spoiler. He's saying that David Corn Sweat was doing snow angels in the snow in his underwear. This suit has snow on it. The S. So he obviously took a picture of him doing snow angels in the snow. And he took a picture of him with the suit. If he's saying he was in his underwear, it's really fucking obvious. He will have trunks, bro. This is a picture that is floating around the internet that is not real. Apparently, this is AI. And I can sort of tell around the fucking neck and especially the hands. The hands, the wrist look. The hands especially look rubbery. So this is AI. And the people, one of the guys who's taking a picture of him, his arms fucked. So this is AI recreating this for somebody. So it is fake. But James Gunn putting on his thread that he could have posted a picture of David Corn Sweat doing the snow angels in his underwear means he's gonna have trunks or the Speedo. He's gonna look like the classic Superman. There's another reason I can prove to you this is fake. It's because in the other picture, the S right there has a border outline yellow. You can clearly see it. This one doesn't. The border's red. So it is fake. But, and the cape is super short, which is lame. Lame as fuck. But, I have a very big hunch that this is probably very close to what James Gunn's Superman is going to look. Maybe he won't have little shorts, but he will have the Speedo. Because he did say he's rolling around in the snow in his underwear. And this fucking picture shows the suit covered in snow. So if he's saying he's the joke that everyone has always said is like, oh, you're in your fucking Supermans. Meaning you're in your tidy whiteys. That means that he's going to have red tidy whiteys. That's James Gunn Superman. This is AI, but my guess is James Gunn is going for a really classic looks. Like, really fucking. I'm happy that there is yellow in this, because that's what was missing in Zack Snyder's, was yellow. It was a really beautiful fucking Superman suit, but it was missing the yellow. That's all I'm saying. Marvel has sucked ass, but I will say Marvel takes chances in at least putting the colors in the fucking, the right colors in the fucking suits. They really do take the chance. I think Thor, even though the movies have sucked ass, Thor has been probably some of the most accurate fucking looking Thors. As far as, you know, the different suits he has, they look exactly, and the color looks exactly like the comic books. Yeah. We'll see if this turns out to be ass. Because James Gunn is a little unorthodox. And DC, the brand, everything except Batman, has been tarnished. And somebody needs to bring life to these brands that should be billion-dollar fucking franchises. But they're not, because the people that have been in control of these franchises are idiots. But I'm done with Superman. And we're done with DC. We're moving on to some Universal. Because guess what, you guys? James Gunn is fucking up even more. Oh, I'm sorry. We're not moving on to Universal. I'm fucking high now. James Gunn is fucking up even more. That he has greenlit a Jurassic League animation movie. A guy who keeps saying that everything's going to be continuity. The movies, the cartoons, and the games will all coincide with each other. He says, yes, let's do a fucking cartoon show about the superheroes who are dinosaurs in the Stone Age fighting supervillains who are dinosaurs. Fuck you, bro. This guy is really bad for the brand, and this kind of fucking dumbass decision making is the reason why he's a bad news for the fucking brand. That's all I'm gonna fucking say. Fuck you. I want to move on from DC, because I was trying to get in to fucking not Universal. I was trying to get in to fucking Disney, the real ass of the show. We got our first images of Tron Ares and details of what this is gonna be. I liked the Tron movies. I have good memories from going to theaters and watching them, because they use the 3D glasses with these movies. And these movies, specifically these movies, in 3D, and the lights and the visuals looked badass. I may not have liked the story, but I enjoyed the entire ride because I was wearing 3D glasses, and that's the type of movie you want to see with that technology. All right, some movies, I'm sorry, you shouldn't be, fuck you, why did you make this 3D? My eyes hurt. There's no reason for you to have made this. This is the type of movie to see with those glasses. But then I hear the plot of this, I think this is the third one. I might be wrong. I think this is the third one, because there was the original one, the second one they made, and then this is the third one. This plot is called Ares, because this is going to revolve around a new program that the other program inside the thing, the AI, makes. And it makes a program called Ares. And it trains Ares, this is the picture of Ares. It trains Ares specifically to leave their little matrix, their world, and come into the human world. And I don't know if he's a spy or he's supposed to gather information and then report back, but basically that's what he's made for. And that's what the movie's going to be. And this is why I think this might be a failure. Because if the beginning of the movie is in the computer world and you're showing badass visuals and the stuff that people like about it, and then that's 20% of the movie, the beginning. And then the rest of the fucking movie is basically the real world, because he's going to come out of the computer and do stuff in the real world. Then it turns into a regular movie, and it's no longer a Tron fucking movie. And I think this has potential to fail because of this, specifically. This little plot point and shit. I don't know. Did any of you guys enjoy the Tron movies? I can't stand the original one because I hate the special effects. It hurts my eyes. My eyes are from the 90s, and my eyes can't take shitty effects like that. But I like the new one that Disney made when they acquired it, the sequel, with the dude. I forget what his name is. Somebody help me. The dude. Jared Leto was in it, and I think he's going to be in this one too. Jared Leto's going to continue in this one as well. I liked the last one, the second one. I liked it a lot, and I saw it with the glasses, and I thought it was cool. I don't know. I'm 50-50 on this. I'm going to wait till the actual trailer to see what type of movie this is going to be. Because the synopsis that they just released makes it sound like it's going to begin as a Tron movie and then transition into the real world and be a regular movie. Where this guy's a human being and he doesn't have all his superpowers anymore. None of this shiny shit. Nothing's going to look good in 3D. And there's probably not even going to be a 3D movie. So I don't even know why the fuck I even... Jeff Bridges. Thank you, Gomer Kyle. Yeah, I don't know. I'm 50-50 with this, and I'm probably pretty much going to wait until the trailer. This looks cool, because it looks like Tron, but when you tell me the synopsis, it moves like, it sounds like you're going to start like Tron and end up as a regular movie, and I'm not going to like that if that's the situation. But we'll see what the trailer ends up. We're going to move on to some more Disney ass, because none other than Ahmed Best, the guy who did the voice and motion capture for Jar Jar Binks and then played a Jedi and I don't know if it was The Mandalorian or Obi-Wan. I don't know when the fuck he did it, but he played a Jedi in one of those fucking shows as a cameo, as a guy and shit. He showed himself in the motion capture suit and he posted on IG, "Just when I thought I was out, they pull me back in. Hashtag mocap, hashtag Star Wars, hashtag Jar Jar Binks, hashtag Activision, hashtag Jedi, hashtag Sith Lord, hashtag Keller and Beck," which is the Jedi he played. Now, right away, this motherfucker just named everything he's ever played. Except for Sith Lord. He also put Activision, which is a company that makes games. So, my guess is, because he's trying to throw people off by naming a bunch of stuff he's already done. But you pick the things he hasn't done. And he hasn't been a Sith Lord. I don't know if he's done motion capture as Jar Jar for Activision. I feel like there's two possibilities. He's doing this for a game and he's going to be a brand new character, possibly a Sith Lord. Or he's going to be a Sith Lord, the mysterious Sith Lord in The Acolyte. That they're talking about. But that might have already been filmed completely, so I might be wrong on that. I don't know. I don't think he's coming back as Jar Jar Binks. That would be the most idiotic decision that Disney Marvel fucking Lucas could ever do. To, hey, they hate this so much, let's bring him back. They're stupid, but they're not that stupid. They're not. No one likes this character. No one. So I know they're not going to do that. Just the fact that he put Activision makes me think this is for a game. And it might be a brand new fucking character completely. That's just my guess. That's it for the Star Wars ass, because there ain't anything, thank God. I don't want to talk about speculations and Mandalorian ass that people are talking about, because it has no significance and no actual spoiler shit. But moving on to Marvel, we now have word and possible confirmation that Kevin Feige and Amy Pascal have finally agreed on something. And supposedly, the agreement for Spider-Man 4. Because Tom Holland is angry and mad because he kind of doesn't want to do Spider-Man anymore. He wants to go and become an actor. But he's kind of obligated because everybody wants him to be Spider-Man. Everybody. The whole world. So they convinced him. And the news story, instead of being Kingpin, and instead of being a multiverse with Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield, now it will be Miles Morales, live action, and Peter Parker will either die or just simply retire and pass on the mantle to Miles, which most likely is what's going to happen. He's not going to die. Or, I don't know, maybe Secret Wars will be a way for him to die or just be deleted, and Miles will be the new Spider-Man. But basically, the new rumor is Spider-Man 4 will introduce Miles Morales. He will possibly be trained by Peter Parker. And he will be, from then on, possibly the new MCU shared Spider-Man that they'll have. So that Tom Holland can go off and do his thing, break up with some Daya and go do real movies and fuck other hotter bitches. Bigger asses and bigger tits. Yeah, that is the supposed new rumor. Miles Morales coming to the MCU, Spider-Man 4, and will be from then on the Spider-Man after Secret Wars or whatever. Passing on the mantle, moving on to wokeness. I, you know what? This still sounds better than, I don't know. I don't know, even know how to feel about this, man. I didn't want multiverse. I kind of don't want Miles Morales yet. And I feel like there's so many villains that this little kid could fight, like the Scorpion. There could have been Morbius and Kraven the Hunter and all this ass, but Sony has ruined it. Venom. Sony has ruined it by making all those movies. Madame Web could have been brought into Peter Parker. All of this could have been integrated, and Sony ruined it by making their separate movies and ruining those characters that cannot be introduced anymore to interact with Peter Parker. So I hope that they're able to pull this off and that we get a good Miles Morales. There's a lot of young black actors out there, man, that are really good. The kid from Stranger Things is really good. And he's young enough to be Miles. I'm just saying, he came out in the Life of Clarence. Book of Clarence. He's really good, man. Kid's good. There's some other guys, but I think they might be too old. I mean, that's the youngest one I can think about. I hope they don't go too young. He has to be at least a fucking 15, 16. You know, he has to be in high school at least. Because Peter, at this time, he's in college. So he's older. So this kid has to be in high school. He has to be young. And I hope they keep a hood on him like this. At least for some part of the movie. But we'll see what ends up happening, man. This might be something good for the MCU. Who knows? We're moving on to more MCU ass. And the Thunderbolts has begun filming. Will come out next year. This is the cast for y'all. And now they're saying that pretty much the number one main character, the main actress, will be little Black Widow, Yelena. Florence Pugh. Big ass Florence Pugh shows her nipples every time she goes out. It's a style nowadays, fellas. Enjoy it. And that Bucky is actually not going to be the second main star of the movie. That it's actually going to be fucking U.S. agent Wyatt Russell. He's going to be, you know, Bucky will be in it, but he's not going to be the second main character. It's going to be Wyatt Russell. So the story's going to be more focusing on Yelena and U.S. agent Wyatt Russell. They're going to be sent on some kind of suicide mission that everyone in the past thought, because the movie is called The Thunderbolts, everyone, including myself, thought the movie was going to be involved with Theodore Thunderbolt Ross, which is in the comic books why they even named the team Thunderbolts. Because Thunderbolt Ross, all the villains that the government captured and has in jail, they make their suicide squad, and he calls them the fucking Thunderbolts. We all know that, unfortunately, William Hurt did die. They replaced him now with Harrison Ford. He's the new Thunderbolt Ross, and he is going to be in the Captain America 4 movie with Sam Wilson. And he will be the Red Hulk. We've seen spoilers of the jackets they give off to the crew. And the jackets has a Captain America fucking shield with a Hulk hand on it. Red Hulk hand. So he will turn into the Red Hulk. The leader is also in it. And they cut off the Serpent Society, which we talked about a few weeks ago. So you would think that a movie called Thunderbolts, after the guy who makes the Suicide Squad, Thunderbolt Ross, calls it Thunderbolts, would have some kind of involvement of the character Thunderbolt Ross. But it will not. And there's a reason why. Because I told you the spoilers had shown that Thunderbolt, there's a funeral. And I'm telling you, Thunderbolt Ross will probably die. The Red Hulk, he's an 80-year-old man, Harrison Ford. If he turns into the Red Hulk, obviously his heart's going to pump faster, and then he's going to overheat and turn on fire. They say he's going to melt the vibranium wings off of Sam Wilson. That's how hot and overheated he's going to become. He's going to have a heart attack and he's going to die. And that's the only reason Harrison Ford even agreed to make the character, is if it was like, this is a one-off. I'm not going to do 40 of these movies. I'm 82 years old. I'm going to die next week. So it's obvious, this is a one-off, he's gonna die in this movie. So, the obvious thing they could have done is said, we're gonna name the Suicide Squad the Thunderbolts in honor of our fallen fucking guy that had the idea to make this team. Right? No. Unfortunately, that is not what they're doing. Apparently, because I'm telling you, Thunderbolt Ross will die in Captain America 4. He will. That's it. I'm telling you. It's a one-off. Harrison Ford will not do more than one movie for this franchise. Apparently, they're going to say that they named the team the Thunderbolts because the main character is Yelena, new Black Widow, Florence Pugh, big ass. They named the team the Thunderbolts because that's her childhood soccer team. Her favorite soccer team growing up. And she's the one who names the team the Thunderbolts. If this is true, which I got a feeling it will be, this is the kind of shit that is ruining Marvel. Dumb decisions like this. Because you could very easily say that this is in memory of this guy who died and started the actual program to make this team. But no. You're not smart enough, and you're going to say it's because this little girl has a favorite soccer team when she was growing up, and it was called the Thunderbolts. Fuck you, Kevin Feige, and fuck you, Marvel, for these idiotic decisions, and for the people you hire to write this ass. ass for you. This is idiocracy, if this is true. And I got a feeling it probably is going to end up being true. But we're not done with the Marvel ass. Because I got to use some spoilers. And we got to use some more supposed Daredevil spoilers. Or at least relating to it. Because I showed you last week that the White Tiger, code name or real name, Hector Ayala, gets shot in the head by the Punisher. Probably going to be in one episode and right away he's going to get killed by Frank Castle. Fuck you. That's the end we're going to see of the first Mexican hero. No, actually the second one. Because we did get little America Chavez and shit. Anyways. But Marvel has a trick up their sleeves. Because they have a plan. Because anybody who knows the comic books knows that his daughter becomes the next White Tiger. And he passes on the mantle. So Marvel says, oh, because Frank Castle kills him. This is the perfect opportunity to say his daughter wants to seek revenge like a Batman story. And so then she takes up the mantle and becomes Tigress. All right. The fans are jumping on board and are already stating, we want Jenna Ortega as fucking a little... I think her name is Ava. Ava Ayala. They want her. Little fucking Jenna Ortega. That's not a bad choice. But if I was Jenna Ortega's agent, I would tell this little girl, you're on fire right now. You're hot. There's tons of deep fake videos on you online. You're getting fucked. They're loving you. The world wants you. Stay away from Disney. Stay away from Marvel. If you want your career to thrive. And I hope that's what her agents are telling her. Because every time the fans go on there and start doing the fan casting, Marvel looks at this and then they start reaching out to them. This is dangerous for her in her career. Because Marvel... You all say it in your little fucking, in your comments. Marvel's ass right now. And we don't need Jenny Ortega throwing her career down the drain for some ass. All right? That's all I'm going to say. She would be perfect. I'm not going to lie. She's Latina. The right size. You want to make young Avengers or young superheroes. Yeah, it's a bit fifth. It's perfect for the profile that Marvel wants. But as an actor, I think you need to stay away from these fucking movies until they start proving themselves to be billion-dollar franchises once more. And right now, they're not good. Fan casting, and thank God that's all this is. Cheers. But I am going to take my last fucking break, and when I come back, we'll finish the show with the entire... Avatar The Last Airbender fucking review. The whole series on Netflix. And I hope you guys are ready for this. That's the main show. I saved it for last. I'm going to show you some videos and give you my opinions. And I'm an actual fan of the goddamn thing. So I'll see you guys in just a little bit. Alright. Let's finish this off. And we're going to finish it off with the Avatar The Last Airbender review. Hope you're ready for this. I know I've been waiting to go over this. There's been a lot of talk, and I'm showing just randomness in the background of all the 8 episodes. This should have been 10 episodes. Right away off the bat. I'll tell you that. The first season, I believe, had like 20-some episodes. It did. M. Night Shyamalan was the first person to attempt... to recreate this into live action. And anyone who watched the original series, because I did, will tell you it's a masterpiece. It's perfect. These guys are American, but they must have watched anime their entire life, that they somehow managed to make the perfect blend of anime slash American slash Eastern philosophies and cultures. It just was perfect. Everything. And not only that, like Mark Hamill, when, because Mark Hamill was the voice of the Fire Lord for the animated. And he said when he read the script, he said, I'll do it. But he says, in my head, I knew this wasn't going to go more than a season. This was not going to be a hit, he said. And he said, the reason why I thought this was going to be a failure was because it was really smart. And he said, this is too smart for children. They're not going to want to watch this. But unfortunately, people in their mid-20s who got bitches pregnant in high school latched onto this. And they set their kids down, and their kids latched onto this, and you had two whole generations latched onto this, and this became a hit. I didn't have kids, but I fucking latched onto this, and I loved it. I was like, holy shit. When I found out that two Americans had done this, I couldn't believe it. I'm like, this fucking looks like this came out of some Japanese motherfucker's mind, but it has that American influence to it, where it is catchy to us, we're a lot faster. And this caught on all over the world. This is huge, the Last Airbender animated series. And so when I saw M. Night Shyamalan in the ass, he crunched 20-some episodes of the first season into an hour and a half, what's the biggest disappointment in the world? A lot of people are complaining about this. I think it has, on the audience, it has like a 70-something percent. And the critics have given it like a 60 or a 50 and shit. Cheers, Joku. Cheers, Gomer. Motherfuckers. But I will tell you this. This is good. I will address their complaints first. The main complaints. They took away the silliness out of it. That anime feeling to it. Because anime is where somebody says something dumb and then the guy's embarrassed and he makes a stupid face like, ah, and you see the drawing and shit with the little drop on top of his head. I get it. Or when Hang is happy and, ah, and the big old eyes and shit. I get it. When we saw One Piece, it wasn't all there, but there was silliness in One Piece. And One Piece is a fantastical world, and it has to have silliness, and the silliness was in One Piece. That anime silliness was in One Piece. It wasn't all the way like the cartoon, because you can't translate the cartoon. You cannot translate it into live action and have it look good. What are you going to do? All of a sudden, he's going to have huge CGI eyes and a little drop on top of his head and weird little fucking line. You can't translate that to live action. You can't. Okay? You cannot. So I understand that. But the fucking showrunners, and maybe this is why the actual creators left the production of this. The showrunners said, we took away the silliness because there is war going on. There are people dying. Aang lost everyone. He is the last of his fucking race. Or not race, but you know, his religion or whatever, faith. He's the last one. Yeah, maybe race, whatever. Airbenders. He's the last one. So Aang wouldn't be, let's go ride penguin sharks and shit. He wouldn't be fucking doing shit like that in real life if that kind of stuff was at stake. It makes sense to me. There is some funny stuff. There is some funny stuff. I'll go into in details with each character in just a little bit. There is some funny stuff in it. But I think that this, for live action, this works a lot better. Another complaint is some of the actors aren't that good. I am going to say I do feel that the people that make this show focused a lot on making it look like the animation as far as the costumes, the characters. There's a few characters I'll get into in a bit that feel like they were pulled straight out of the animation. Not only by look, sometimes they're acting or whatnot. I'll get into some of that in a bit. But I think they focused on that more than they did trying to find quality actors. Also, the budget, shit goes in line, you know? You also don't want to pick, you know, fucking Brad Pitt and shit like that. Isn't your whole budget's going to go off on getting a big actor. So there's shit like that in it. And I understand shit like that. Right off the bat, Aang took me 2 episodes to like this kid. Because, and this also is because of the translation into from the anime to this. Aang is very lovable because he's very kiddish and he does play around and joke around a lot. But if you are going to translate this into this is the real world and there's war and he just lost everything, this kid is not going to be joking around and being happy all the fucking time. So that does make sense. But because of that, it took me 2 episodes to say I like this actor as Aang. It did take me a few episodes. There's other actors in this, but like, since I'm gonna get into, I'm showing you a lot of the stuff I'm showing you right now is literally pulled, like some of the stuff that's pulled straight from the fucking anime. I mean, some of this looks exactly like it. There's the Jet storyline. That's another thing people complained about is that they crunched. Oh, one episode had 3 stories. One episode had Umashu. It had the lovers cave in it. And it had the Jet storyline. And it had the fucking cripple kid and the father betraying for making ships for the fire. It had all of that squished into one episode. Oh, and also Zuko and fucking Iroh in Umashu for the first time. So it had like 5 or 6 episodes all smushed into 1 episode. But you're trying to do 20 episodes in 8. This could have been 10, but the budget allowed them only for 8. You can't blame them. They're lucky they got 8 episodes. Back in the day, I mean, you know, you get so many episodes for the first season because they don't know if it's going to be a hit or not. They don't know. So we're lucky we got 8 episodes. We could have gotten 6 and it could have really, really sucked ass. But we got 8 episodes and they had to smush stuff together. There was at least 2 or 3 episodes that, yeah, I saw a lot of stuff crushed into it. And as the next episode was, every episode I saw twice. Before I moved on to the next one, I made sure I saw it twice because I really wanted to make sure my final decision of what I was seeing, whether I really liked it or not. I saw it twice before I moved on to the next one. So yes, I will tell you that. I am very happy with it. But let me go into more specifics with the characters in general. Team Avatar. Like I said, Aang took me at least 2 episodes for me to get used to him. The one biggest problem that I have with it, yes, they took away the silliness, but I'm not going to judge it because of that, because they're going for a different aesthetic here. The one biggest problem that I have with Aang is that this little boy, because obviously he probably hasn't had a lot of acting experience. That's not his fault. Sometimes he says the lines a little too fast and his words sound like, that's not like him. Yeah, but I'm not him. Sounds a little bit like that. I am from a weird generation, because they and then I've noticed this a lot, but they say millennials like to see their movies with subtitles. I don't consider myself a millennial. I think I'm in between Gen X and millennials. What was in between that phase? Between those years. So I'm a little bit of both. But I am one of those people that I do really, really prefer my movies with subtitles, because I sometimes don't understand certain words some actors pronounce or say, and I like to see it. And I'm like, okay, I know what he said. So, but I did notice that this kid, especially towards some of the lines at the end, he was a little, and it bothered me. But I have subtitles, so I knew what I could read what he was saying, but I understand that if I didn't have subtitles, that would bother me. Katara! She looks great. At the same time, I don't want to trash these actors because they're children. They are children. I don't want to trash children. Some of these might be their first acting jobs. I don't know their history. I didn't do enough research. Guitar is very amateurish, you know? I think this little girl has a lot to work on as far as performance-wise. When it came to the serious tones and the serious stuff, conversations she would have with Aang, I didn't feel it. Like I said, I don't enjoy this. I don't want to trash children. I'm just giving my opinion. Sokka. I saw there, the Super Saiyan Joker says Sokka could have been funnier. Yes, he could have. But like I told you, they didn't want to direct translate it because there's war going on and shit. I thought Sokka to me was one of the very few characters that felt like he was directly pulled from the anime because of the way he looks. I don't know where they found this kid, but to me, that's the way the character was drawn. I mean, he looks like the goddamn cartoon. His face, features, everything. And he delivered the sarcastic lines perfectly because there is war going on. So he is not gonna be Jim Carrey like he was in the anime. It took me 2 episodes to get over that. Because, yes, everyone, that's the biggest complaint. It's not like the anime, because One Piece was really silly. Yeah, One Piece was silly, but One Piece is a little kid or a fucking pre-teenager who dreams of becoming a pirate and going on adventures. This is war and people are dying, so this could be like World War II. This could be not the Nazis taking over other countries. This is the situation of the matter. So if you're going to bring this into live action, I did honestly expect this. Less silliness. And that's what they did. But Sokka, to me, is one of the very few characters that is the most like the anime. This kid looks like Sokka. And the lines he fucking would deliver, the sarcastic lines. He goes, because Aang's all like, I'm the Avatar, and it's my duty to save the world. And then Sokka's all like, oh, is that it? Oh, is that all you gotta do? Oh yeah, we'll do it tomorrow. Yeah, it's a sick. Like, it was so perfect, because I was just like, yes, it's real world, it's not over the top, but this kid, delivered the lines just perfectly. Sokka, in this series, is my favorite actor and character in this series. In the anime, it wasn't. I call it anime even though it's American. American-ay? Is that what people call it? American-ay? I don't know. People are assholes. It was really good. My favorite character in the American-ay was Uncle Iroh. Over Aang and everyone was Uncle Iroh. It took me 5 or 6 episodes for this actor to grow on me as Iroh. Because Uncle Iroh in the anime had a certain, I don't know, there was something about him. The way he spoke, the way he delivered his lines. And this man, I felt, didn't have it. And it bothered me a lot. I hated it at first, but when it started getting to me that I was like, okay, was when I saw this, the bottom that I'm showing you, is they show something. Look, the show shows you stuff straight out of the animation, but it also shows you stuff that wasn't in the animation that might have been implied, or maybe people imagined this might have happened in between. They show you stuff that's not, that wasn't there. And the stuff that they show that wasn't there is good. God damn it. Sometimes I think it's even better, because when you try to translate certain scenes from the animation to live action, you let people down because it's not going to be exactly the same. It's not. The beginning, the intro beginning, fire, water, earth, it was different. And actually, the grandmother said the exact lines from the intro during the first episode. I don't know if people caught that. I'm going back a little. But so they changed stuff around. And the stuff that they've added that was not in the animation, that stuff has been really good. They added Zuko at Wang. I think his name's Wen. Oh, fuck, I don't even want to disrespect it because I love this so much. Wen Chu or Wen Chao, something like that. Uncle Iroh's his son that dies in the war. That's, if you know the story, is that Iroh was actually next in line to become Fire Lord. And he was a great general. And he was about to take siege of Ba Sing Se. He took Ba Sing Se. And he was about to take siege of Umashu. And when he was about to, he was attacking Umashu for 5 fucking days. And when he was about to finally finish them off, he finds out through telegram or whatever that his son, who they had also made a general, he was already in his 20s. He died in a battle in war. And this guy has a mental breakdown. And because of that, because he never goes back to being a general because he's so heartbroken, they put Ozai as next in line and he becomes Fire Lord. And this guy, you know, he doesn't ever become Fire Lord, even though he's the eldest. But they show him at the funeral and they show Zuko talking to him. And you get this relationship, you know, build up. Another thing, let's talk about Zuko. Because I said that's the point that, to me, this actor then started to shine on me, because it's like, okay, it's not the Iroh from the animation that I love. This is another Iroh, and he's a little different. And this actor's now showing me what he's capable of in these emotional scenes. I still think he could do a little better. There's always room for improvement for all of them. Oh, as if this gets renewed, as the seasons go on, actors get better. They get more comfortable in their roles. So there's always room for improvement and things could get better. But I felt it there. And that's when I started liking Iroh. And I started liking the actor when I saw those scenes that were not even in the animation. These are scenes that Netflix made up. And they're good. They're fucking good. Zuko. I think his name is Danny Liu. He played the young Shang-Cha in Shang-Cha, the Ten Rings for Marvel. In the flashback, he said he played the teenager. I think he's the only actor who actually knew martial arts in the production. He didn't need a stunt double. This fucking kid did all this shit. Cheers, Gomer. We'll see you next week. Thank you for being here. This kid's good. This kid's really good. He's a good actor. I love Zuko. Everything about it. I will say the big change they did do to Zuko is they really, really, really wanted to make him likable. And they did introduce... I'll go into this further. But they really wanted to make him... I want to jump ahead. Sorry. They really wanted to make Zuko likable, that they changed some of his story. Because I feel like in the anime, Zuko was a real fucking asshole. He was a real fucking asshole. And he didn't really become likable until season 3 when he had no choice. No, it was season 2 when he got stuck with Katara. He got stuck in the caves, and he started becoming a good guy. And then Azula got to him, became an asshole again. But, you know, this one, from the very beginning, it starts showing you that he's honorable. He likes following the rules and the chain of command, and he's all about honor. And they didn't really show that much in the anime. He was always, to me, he was kind of always an asshole. So there is a change here. But I feel like that change was necessary because, for whatever reason, the showrunners introduced Azula. Well, I don't want to jump into this. I'm sorry. There's two more characters I want to talk about. Another guy that was ripped straight off of the anime is Commander Gene. This guy with the fucking sideburns that looks like a monkey. Dude, that guy, just like Sokka, that guy was pulled straight out of the fucking... That guy right there, he's pulled straight out of the fucking anime, that dude. I don't know how they find some of these guys. It's like, dude, it looks like the fucking cartoon they fucking drew. It's fucking nuts. That guy was good. You know, I was just like, I was more amazed at how much he really does look like the drawing. His face. I was just like, wow, they found a guy who looks just like him. Commander Zhao. General Zhao, or whatever the fuck. Admiral Zhao, whatever he gets promoted to. That motherfucker is the guy from fucking, what was it called? Rush Hour 2. I think it was part 2. Or was it the first one? It might have been the first one, I think. It was the first one. It was the guy with the blonde hair. And it took me a while to realize that. That guy was fucking good. And he was really, really good. I mean, he didn't look like Zhao. Look, the main thing that at first was a problem to me, but it didn't matter, was that to me, when I watched The Last Airbender animation, the Fire Nation, to me, were Caucasian. They were whites. The other nations were other different races. But to me, the way they were drawn, to me, the Fire Nation was whites. It was Caucasian. It was the white man. That's what the story was to me. And that's what the way it looked. So it was weird that they made them all fucking Chinese. It was really fucking weird. But it's okay, I guess. Commander Zhao was fucking badass. I liked him in this. But what I wanted to get into earlier is that the showrunners, for whatever reason, I don't know their reasoning for this, but they introduced Azula in this. I want to talk about her before I talk about Ozai. But they put Azula in this. And I had seen her in the trailers, and I was all like, why is she in it? And she doesn't come in until fucking season 2. But I was like, okay, so they're going to put her in this. I mean, when I saw the trailer, right away I was like, it does not look like her. This little girl, it looks a little chubby, and, you know, whatever. It doesn't look like her. It doesn't translate well. Like I said, I don't want to shit on these actors because a lot of them are children. I don't want to be that guy who shits on children. Just trying to be as honest as I can without being an asshole. It didn't look like her. And then I saw the scene when the other Mei Jing, and I forget what the other chick's name is, who is Zuko's fucking girlfriend. And they don't even look nothing like them either. And that's my biggest problem, is because I think, to me, in the animation, the fucking firebenders were white. They were Caucasian. So when you cast Asians, it doesn't look like them. I think the little girl, which was Zuko's girlfriend, the gothic one that's like this, I think that one really was Asian in the anime, but the other characters were Caucasian. I think Aang was Caucasian too. You know? Because I know in the fucking airbenders, they were all different. But Aang was Caucasian to me. The lightning scene, thank you, Super Saiyan Goku, was super lame. And I think was one of the shittiest scenes they ever they did in the entire 8 episodes. It was the shittiest. Because The buildup was badass. And then she goes, and it's like this little spark. And it's like, motherfucker, that's for you to have made a big lightning bolt and destroyed half of the building, like the top of it. Look, that scene was ass. She doesn't look like her. Her little friends don't look like the characters. But every scene those three little girls performed, they acted and portrayed those characters. This little girl is evil. You saw it in her face. All her lines were delivered perfectly. The same with the other two little girls. It still bothers me. They do not look like the cartoon. Some of the other, a lot of the actors look almost exactly, if not 80%, like it. These little girls look nothing like, those three little girls look nothing like them. But the acting is good. Their acting is superb. I cannot doubt that. They're good. And maybe in season two, when we see more of them, because season two will have to have all three of them in it. Maybe I'm going to fall in love with them more. Because right now, because they really did have they were just sprinkled on season one. They had 2-minute scenes in one or three episodes. It wasn't that much they were in it. So, I didn't have time to really, to have them grow on me the way Uncle Iroh grew on me. Because I hated Iroh and he grew on me. I didn't like Aang the first two episodes and he grew on me. I don't have enough time to have these girls grow on me. But I can tell you in the scenes I did see that they are good actresses. Maybe if I see them more, I'll get used to it. Fire Lord Ozai. Like I said, to me, he should have been a Caucasian man. But this guy's good. I remember him from Lost and some other movies. This guy looks badass. I mean, I can never, never deny the look of this show. The money, they spent the money perfectly in the visual effects. Yeah, some stuff. I mean, come on. How are you going to make a flying buffalo look fucking real? Yeah, some of it's going to look fucking fake. But this looks good. All of it visually looks amazing. And the costumes. It looks like you are in that world. There's nothing normal out of it. This is another fucking world you're transported to. And I love that. Fire Lord Ozai is scary. This guy is menacing. He's perfect. Fast and the Furious, you're right. He was in Fast and the Furious. He's the one who died, right? He's the one who fucking... No, he didn't die. His girlfriend died who fell off the airplane and got run over or some ass, I think. I don't remember. It has been a long time since I've seen those movies, Joku. But yes... This guy's good. This guy's a good Fire Lord Ozai. And it's the scene when he burns Zuko is super hardcore. I think it's even more hardcore than the show, because in the show, it's been a long time since I've seen it. But in the show, I think he just throws a fireball and hits him. In this one, he burns his shoulder and then he pins him on the ground and then slowly just starts to burn his face. This show is hardcore, man. People die. They show people dying. And I love this show. I love this show, and I'm not going to deny anything from it. People want to talk shit about it. They are very, very faithful to it, where they literally showed the best parts. The Kiyoshi episodes. Avatar Kiyoshi is amazing. Suki. Beautiful little girl. They couldn't have chosen anyone more beautiful to be fucking Sokka's mate, the partner. Avatar Kyoshi, I want a whole series. I've always, since the first anime, I've always wanted an Avatar Kyoshi series. This crippled kid and his dad from Community are perfect. Jet and the fucking Freedom Fighters all looked exactly like it. It was perfect. I will say I didn't like Bumi. Bumi was rushed. His arc was rushed. And it was weird. I didn't like it. This fucking weird creature thing was perfect. Some of it was kind of different. Some of the story was a little different. This chick and the bounty hunter, amazing. Everything to the T. It was perfect. I kind of had a problem with how Avatar Roku is, but this keeps going back to how I keep telling you the firebenders are supposed to be Caucasian. They're the bad guys, the white man. That's what the series had done. And so when they put an Asian man there instead of a white man, it does alter my vision. I loved it all. I loved everything they did. And for everyone who is complaining and talking shit about this series, fuck you. All I'm gonna say is that it's still better than this piece of shit they gave us fucking almost, what, 15 years ago? Fuck you. I was so excited. I fucking paid for a lot of my friends' tickets because they didn't want to go see it. But I paid for their tickets because I knew if I went to that theater, there was going to be the only fucking 20-some-year-old in there. There was going to be a bunch of little kids and families. So I bought their tickets and we all went. And they had seen the series with me because I would make them, when they come over, I'd be watching it and they see it and they're like, it's cool. You can see them badass. And so they expected something cool. But this was trash. This was trash. And we finally got something half decent. Not even half decent. I fucking rate this as an 85%. Because yes, the silliness is out of it and it does take, you know, shit out of the anime. It's never going to be perfect. It's never. But this is really good. And people should not be complaining about this. People should be happy of how good this actually is. Because it is. I hope. I pray. That people continue to watch this. This is right now the number one watch show on Netflix. Premiering the first 4 days. It got like 22 million views. But it's got a lot to still catch up to. Stranger Things and what was that other one? I forget. It's Squid Games. They have billions of views. I hope people keep watching this. It already debuted higher than One Piece, and One Piece got renewed for a second season. So I hope to God this gets renewed for a second season. I have faith that if it does, I have faith that all the actors are only going to get better at their roles. They are. It comes with experience. And like I said, it's obvious some of these little young children, they don't have that much experience. They haven't been alive for that long. They haven't had that many jobs, for fuck's sakes. Give them a fucking break. They're going to grow. They're going to get more comfortable with being in front of a camera and doing this kind of shit. This will get better. This is good. I want everybody to watch this. I recommend this. Fuck you, all you haters hating on this. It's never going to be the anime. An American nay. It's never going to be the American nay. And I think you should be fucking talking shit about it. I think it's good. It's better than Cowboy Bebop. And it's better than fucking Death Note. I'll tell you like that. And better than another... I didn't even see it. The one with the little kid with the three eyes and shit. This is good. This is good. I hope people watch this. And I hope this continues to be a success. From the underground. But with that being said, let me get rid of fucking Aang here. No, you know what? I'm going to leave Aang up here. Because he would like this shit. We're done with the show. And I'm done with ranting for tonight. So I'm going to leave you with a little bit of life advice. Right. And this is some shitty life advice, but it's the best I can do, because I'm drunk and high. So here we go. Life sucks. That's all life is. It's suckiness and shittiness. And it's your job to find happiness in between all the suckiness and shittiness. And you just have to keep moving forward. And if you keep moving forward and live towards... Or, you know, towards those happy moments. And it makes life better. But life is not easy. Not for the rich, and not for the poor, and not for the middle class. Everyone struggles and everyone suffers. Stop fighting with each other. Fuck you. And cheers to the woke pack. And I'll catch you next week, and it's always gonna be...
or live.
Cheers!